They have come from near. They have come from afar. And they have come from nowhere. For 100 years, the world's best have journeyed down under to be crowned the Australian Open champion. Over the past century, the Open has been the stage for the game's greatest players. A stage that has seen true theatre unfold for Australian golf's most prized piece of silverware, the Stonehaven Cup. The names that have carved its history are as big as the game itself. The immortals of the sport have etched their names on this cup. Along with an impeccable list of previous international champions, the greats of Australian golf have also taken their piece of history. Thompson, Newton, Norman, and of course our living national treasure, the Von, Norman Von Neider. Today is a chance for one of the new breed to join the greats of the sport and mark their name on the Stonehaven Cup. The final round at the Australian Golf Club in Sydney will round off 100 years of Open history and begin a new era in Australian golf. The pride of our national title is on the line. Welcome to day four of the 2004 Hillross Australian Open.
Yes, isn't this a magnificent layout? This is the Australian Golf Club, nestled between the city itself of Sydney and the airport. For the 16th time, it is hosting our national championship. This is the 2004 Hillross Australian Open title, and it promises to be an exciting and quite possibly a very dramatic afternoon. Hello everyone and welcome. Yes, we're looking forward to bringing you the final 18 holes at this year's championship. It is an open finish and I hope you can stay with us right throughout the day when at the end of the day a brand new name will go on to the Stonehaven Cup. It's nice to welcome a man who knows what it takes, what it's like to win a championship. Our 79 champion, Jack Newton. Welcome Jack, it's one of your favourite days in world sport, the final day of our national championship.
Yes Andy, I'm really pumped about today. I think that there'll be a lot of nerves out there today because it is the Open. More importantly, the Centenary Open. Of course, my old mate Kel Nagle won the Centenary British Open and he's always remembered for that. And I think we're going to have something similar this week. A lot of experience at the top of the leaderboard and one youngster called Kurt Barnes, a country kid from Musselbrook.
How would the players, those in contention, now be feeling? You know what it's like. You're going into the final day, massive crowds, and the name that could go on to the Stonehaven Cup. How are they feeling before teeing off?
Yeah, look, there'll be a lot of nerves, even for the experienced players, but you'd have to think that the experience comes into play. There'll be a lot of hard luck stories, good luck stories, and there'll be one name goes on the Stonehaven Cup. This is a big chance for a lot of people to win their first Australian Open. And as a kid growing up, you just dream about winning the Australian Open. So there's a lot of pressure added to the event because of that.
Weather conditions may play a part, more on that later. Let's have a look at those in contention. And the man who's been leading the way for the past couple of rounds is Rod Pampling. Can he win his first national title?
Yeah, look, I think that Rod's probably still the favourite to win the event. He's had a great year in America. And of course, Richard Green, who hasn't been a prolific winner, but he's had a fantastic year in Europe this year, and he may just be ready.
I can tell you one thing today, Jack. The town of Musselbrook will be very quiet. They're all in watching this man on their television screens.
Look, a lot of people have discarded Kurt Barnes, but I still think he can win this championship. I think the important thing for him is just to keep the loose shots off his scorecard today. We've seen him play a couple of loose ones, but he makes a lot of birdies.
Paul Gow, he stood up yesterday.
Look, the front nine yesterday, come after a bogey at one, he just drilled the flag out and then just let it go in the middle stages of his round, but certainly makes a lot of birdies and he's had a fantastic year this year on the nationwide tour in the States.
Stuart Appleby was an emotional winner in 2001. He's looking for his second national title.
Look, he was very scrappy yesterday, Sandy, on the outward half. I think he went out in four over par, but he brought it home, brought it back to the house in three under. And don't discard him. He's coming off an excellent year in America and a lot of experience.
So let's have a look at the overnight leaderboard as it stands after the third round. And Rod Pampling, after one stage, he led by four shots. He goes into the final round leading by one. From the lefty, Richard Green, then comes Kurt Barnes, a further shot back. At two under are Paul Gow and Stuart Appleby. And Camilo Villegas, one of our visitors from Colombia, is at one under. Just six players under par. But there are a number of other players too that are at even par and even at one over. You can't discount, especially if the weather, as has been predicted, may change rather dramatically.
Yeah, don't forget that this is a very, very difficult golf course. It's a serious examination, as it should be for the Australian Open.
Yeah.
But boy, if you get stuck out on that back nine with a filthy southerly blowing, it's hang on to your hats, ladies and gentlemen. So someone on even par or even one over gets out, posts a score, and leaves these leaders with a score to shoot at, as we saw with Greg Norman and Brian Jones at the Lakes many years ago now. But Jones should have won that, but he got stuck out on the back nine at the Lakes in a filthy southerly, and Norman won the championship.
Indeed he did. Well, we'll check on the weather in more detail in just a moment, but first let's meet some of the team. Good morning once again to Brett Ogle.
Well, I'm standing here with 1991 Australian Open champion Radar Wayne Riley and fellow Channel 7 commentator. Mate, it should be a great day. Looking forward to calling the shots out there today. It's hot, but it's going to be good. Now, the two guys you'll be following on course today, who have you got? I've got Gow and Barnes. Experience versus power. With Barnes' power, it's going to be unbelievable out there to call shots. Don't know what club he's going to be hitting because he hits it so far, it's unbelievable, but it's going to be fun. Now, your prediction at the start of the week was who? Pamps. I believe the way he's playing with his confidence of this year, winning in the States for the first time, the International in Denver, he's going to be hard to beat. Now, two words come to mind with the Centenary Australian Open. Class and prestige. What about this 33-foot Riviera right here on the ninth hole? The Porsche of boats. It'll look fantastic on the back of my jetty at my home in Oatley in Sydney. It'll be fantastic, but I don't know if I could afford this. Well, I'll tell you what, Sandy. You may just see us today. Maybe not.
Being on the Porsche of boats, Brett, maybe not, but I hope you can join us in the commentary box a little bit later on. One man who's going to be out on the fairways with Radar Riley is Pat Welch, and he's got all the latest weather. He hasn't been 100% accurate so far this week, but Pat, what can you give us today?
Sandy, it's golf season. Things change very, very rapidly out here, as you know. Look, at this stage, the storm is predicted for this afternoon, just what time it arrives. And as we know, come the storm, come the southerly buster. And that could really change the complexion of this golf tournament dramatically later on this afternoon. But right now, it's very, very muggy. It's overcast, and they're tipping a top of around about 34 degrees. So it's going to be sticky and uncomfortable for the senior players because they haven't quite arrived at the range as yet. They'll be out here shortly. But right now, I can tell you that behind me on the range is a couple of former Open champions in Peter Senior and Roger Davis. And because they're out here so late practicing, it means they have late tee times. They could well be in contention come late this afternoon if they can get out post a score, and then the southerly buster and the storm arrives. I'm keeping my fingers crossed that storm doesn't arrive until after about 5:30.
I had a feeling you may be keeping your fingers crossed, Pat, but we'll hear from you right throughout the afternoon. And that's interesting. Someone could post a score, so we'll just have to see what happens. But in the meantime, there's been plenty of action.
To the first tee. Pat, we're set to go.
Ladies and gentlemen, at the Hillross Centenary Australian Open, our final group, leading off a player who's enjoyed a superb European season where he had six top 10 finishes, including seconds at the European, French and KLM Opens. A former winner of the Dubai Desert Classic with rounds of 67, 75 and 67 to be four under from Victoria, Richard Green.
He's rewriting the history books in Dubai. The first left-hander to win on the European Tour since Bob Charles back in 1974.
Boy, could he roll his nugget. And look, the thing that impressed me most about Richard Green yesterday, obviously I haven't seen him play much during his European season. His rhythm was fantastic. His chipping was good. Everything looked pretty strong. And in his interview before he hit off, he sounded confident. On the short grass, but as I said, that's going to be an awkward shot.
And last away, ladies and gentlemen, our tournament leader this year celebrated his debut victory on the US Tour, winning the International in Colorado. He's now ranked number 63 in the world with rounds of 67, 67 and 74 to be five under. From Queensland, Rod Pampling.
Yeah, it's a great year. 10 top 25s and finished 17th in the all-round rankings on the US Tour. No doubt he has arrived on the world stage.
Look, the only thing I didn't like about what happened yesterday with Miz Rod was he started to hit a few shots left. And that's always been his nemesis. He's really improved that part of his game. The first 2 days, he didn't look like missing a shot. But I suppose if you're going to have one average round, the third round's not a bad time to do it when you're right in contention and leading. Opening tee shot, important for Pampling. Doesn't want to go left.
Shot, Rod.
Well, it's not in the trees like it was yesterday, but as I said, that's still going to be an awkward shot from there. Got those overhanging branches to contend with in the pin way left. General good luck there from Craig Parry as he walked past.
The field is away. We move ahead to the first, and this is Kurt Barnes playing in the second last group.
Tricky chip, very quick across here. Testy one at the first for par.
And while the pros are battling it out, so two are our top five amateurs. Keep an eye on their scores throughout the afternoon, but Jason Day at the moment has his nose in front. Yes, that's the way to do it. That is the way to do it, Paul Gow. The tie for third at three under par.
And I tell you, when this guy gets his tail up, Gowie, he's tough to beat. I know he had 3 seconds this year, but what a way to start the final round of the Centenary Open.
Well, just put it in perspective, Brett, there's only been one other, as we said just a few moments ago, one other birdie here. A little chip in three for the boy from Cumberland, Sydney. Big putt. Shot for the young fella at the first. He makes a lot of birdies though, so let's hope that he can get this back on track pretty well straight away. But nerves, 100th Australian Open, or the Centenary Open. Of course, they haven't played 100 Australian Opens because of the war years. The First World War and Second World War, the tournament wasn't played for 5 years in each instance. So there's a 10-year deficit there. But it's the 100th centenary of the first Open, which was played in 04. 1904, that is.
Man on screen.
Second or third oldest tournament, Brett, sorry?
British Open 1860, Canadian Open 1904, and then the Australian Open in 1904. Mm. It's amazing, isn't it?
Steeped in history, and that's why I guess Nicklaus and Player and company always thought this event should have been the fifth major.
Yeah, well, you can look at it. Jack Nicklaus said that, Faldo said that, Gary Player said that, and when those guys usually say something like that, Jack, they usually mean it.
Well, the history and tradition's there. I mean, In the early days when Kerry Packer was the major sponsor, the prize money here was very comparable with the biggest tournament in America. There's the locations of Pampling and Green from the first.
Yeah, the thing that's gone wrong since then, Jack, since the 70s, is the money proportion in America has just blown it out.
Yeah.
These guys now want, the top guys, they want $100,000, $200,000 US dollars to come and play on our shores. And by the time they figure it out, take tax out, get out here, long years, they're just not bothered. And I think that's pathetic. And they should follow Bob Estes and some of these other guys that come out here. And like you said yesterday, get off their fat paychecks and start travelling the world.
They should be made to.
Well, I don't think they can, Sandy.
No, but they should.
I posed that question to Tim Fincham when I was involved at the tour, but... I want to give a big rap to people like Hillross, MasterCard and Optus who not only have supported golf at this end, but junior golf end. We badly need some of our big corporates to put their hand up. Richard Green, second shot to the first. Started left. Is it coming back? Right over the top of the stick. too long, and that's a tough, tough chip from there because he's on the downslope with no green to work with.
Do you remember what he did yesterday, Jack, on the first?
Chipped it in.
And Jack, just to finish that discussion, the irony is that we've got some of the world's best golfers anyway.
Absolutely. I think the Australian golfing public really need to get that message that, hey, we're good here. These guys are good.
Now, a pumped up Paul Gow on two. Three under. Two off the pace.
Five iron, Sandy. Hit very high. Oh, I don't know if it's going to reach. Oh, you don't want it. Very tricky chip from there. Tough up and down.
And just to keep talking about, just quickly, one more thing too, Jack. You know, Tim Finchin put the pressure on Ernie Els this year. He played 16 events. Told Ernie Els that we want to see you more in America, and said, okay, if you want to, you want another release out of America, you've got to play five more American tournaments. Ernie pretty much stuck his middle finger up and said, I'll play your minimum amount of events, which is 16 on the US tour. Adam Scott played a minimum, nothing said about him. Mm. Craig Parry won this year, nothing said about him. Picking on Ernie Els, another one is Retief Goosen, who travels the world. Good on him. And Ernie just said, no, I'm going to continue to play worldwide. That's what it's all about. That's what it is, world golf is all about.
Pampling now. Second shot to the first.
Started way right. Is it coming back? Trap. In the bunker at the first. So everything a little edgy at the moment, as you might expect in the final round of...
Yeah, what can Kurt do? He's dropped a shot at the first.
Started it way right, guys. Drawing on the wind. Nice shot. Dance floor. Long way from where the band hums.
Riley speak. Yes, it's interesting, isn't it? Pampling. His round is away, but Paul Gow is the early mover, and watch out for Stuart Appleby. This magnificent Australian Open layout. We're seeing some excellent golf. And the first of our Schweppes hot shots in this hour comes from Stephen Leaney on the second. And I don't think we'll see too many better than this on this hole today, Jack.
No, I don't think you will, Sandy, because that's the main pin. It's just sitting on a little ridge, and if you're just to the right or short, you kick on down to the right. That's a classic shot there. I want to give Schweppes a rap too. They've been big supporters of golf in this country.
For a long time.
Absolutely.
Rod Pampling now. His third shot to this opening hole.
Hey, that's going to go down the tier, I think.
Yeah, this is really throwing a cat amongst the pigeons. Remember, Richard Green is at the moment a stroke behind at four under. Paul Gow has already picked up a shot today. He's at three under, but he's got his work cut out here at the second, playing his second.
Harder than Chinese arithmetic, that shot, Sandy.
Yeah, but he's going to struggle.
He just had to get it on the dance floor, really, because he had no shot. If he messes with this fringe grass, it could have kicked in the bunker.
And the man in the middle is Richard Green at four under.
Clever little shot. Clever shot from Richard Green.
So he's got that for par.
Kurt Barnes, long putt across the green here at two. He just got on the wrong side of the slope. Pampling's pants there fluttering, so the breeze is starting to pick up. And that's going to be a drop shot for the championship leader.
Pampling and Green at the moment. And four under leading the way.
Par putt for Paul Gow. Well, he gives it straight back after chipping in for birdie at the first.
but he's no further behind.
It's a tough start here though, Sandy. Mm. Tough par four to start with. This is a no gimme par three. And then the fourth hole, which has been causing us plenty of problems this week.
Richard Green. Good solid four. Talk about his year this year. Back-to-back runner-up finishes in the French and the European Open. And then not long after that, another runner-up in the Dutch.
And now with a share of the lead. I can tell you that Kurt Barnes tapped in at two. He got his par.
And a nice controlled shot from Stephen Leaney. At the fourth. The third.
One of seven players in the red figures. Time, Jack, for another Hill Ross flyover. This time, this par three second.
It's the most exposed part of the golf course there. Probably the highest point here in the first. And it's been lengthened considerably, this hole. It's not going to play 194 metres today where that pin is cut. Players have 175 to the front and the pin's on 10, so 185 to the flag. You really need to pitch this around the front edge of the green and let it just skip up. Easier said than done because of the elevation from this tee. Started it to the left. And that's on the beach, and that is a mean, mean bunker shot.
Well, more than 50% of those players we've seen since coming on air have found that trap.
You talk about this golf course, it predominantly runs north and south, but there's three holes in the front and three on the back that run east-west. And the wind off the west, the first playing downbreeze, the second straight back into it going westerly. Then you've got the sixth hole which runs west. And then you have, on the back nine, you have 15, 16 and 17 run east and west.
Should be a perfect shot for Rod Pambley. His stock shot shapes from right to left. Oh, we thought that was gone.
Still is, Jack.
Oh, hang there. Oh.
Tread lightly.
Ahead to Stuart Appleby. He's at the moment a couple under.
This. He's laid up short of the lake by about half a metre.
And still found the beach.
Probably a suggestion of being too close to the green there, Brett.
Stephen Leaney played the second magnificently, picked up a birdie. Not to be here at five, though.
I'll let you know that Alastair Presnell, young Victorian, has birdied the ninth to go out in 31, 4 under for the day and now 1 under for the championship. And you want to talk about the wind or the weather changing later on this afternoon and somebody posting a score. He shoots 2 or 3 under on the back and shoots a 66 and gets it to 4 under. My goodness.
Yes, he's the seventh player to move into red figures, as you can see there. Alastair Presnell, a great effort as we take a break. Moment, and we go back to 1948, the battle between Ozzie Pickworth and Jim Ferrier, legendary. There was history between these two greats, both grew up on the fairways of the Manly Golf Club. Ferrier, the club secretary's opportune son, Pickworth, the boy from the pro shop. Pickworth had taken out back-to-back opens in 46 and 47, while Ferrier chose to travel abroad and in so doing claimed the US PGA title that same year. Well, after a monumental 4 rounds at Kingston Heath, the two combatants finished in the first tie in Open history. They returned on Monday for 18 holes in the playoff. It was Pickworth by 3 shots. A famous victory and the only hat-trick of titles in 100 years of the Stonehaven Cup.
Sandy, a little addition to that. When I was a kid, first went to Melbourne, a guy called Titch Willison caddied for me, and he used to caddy for Ozzie Pickworth.
Is that right?
And every hole I played at Kingston, he said, Ozzie wouldn't hit it here, he did it over there. I said, mate, I'm not Ozzie Pickworth.
There.
Great player, though, from all accounts.
Richard Green. Out of the sand. Playing it pretty well. Let's have a look at Stuart Appleby. Now, this, in fact, the reason he was so close to the water is he took a drop because he found the water, and this is a putt for bogey.
Oh. Been hitting 3 wood off that tee, and it's not necessary. And maybe he's miscalculated the breeze and hit it too far in the drink.
Kurt Barnes is currently at 2 under. The fans from Muzzlebrook trying to urge that ball, Rod Pampling trying to urge that ball into the hole. They're all in red today, Jack, confusing us.
Yeah, I wouldn't have thought that was a good colour to wear today in this heat. Want some light colours on. Reflects the heat. Paul Gowan out. That's caught the tier in front of the pin there. We needed another metre.
Richard Green, this putt for par. And we came out of the trap to here at the second. Testing putt.
Good try. Stroke looks good though.
So he has a tap in and should make that, but it's a drop shot. Now Kurt Barnes.
Kurt with some kind of wedge, or he's tried to really hit it hard, or he's left it right, flirting with the water. Will it sit there?
I think he's been
very lucky.
A little fortunate, you're right, Radar. Let's see what he's had to contend with here, Jack, over this third, the Hillross flyover, 343-metre par 4.
Well, it poses a question from the tee, because it's not a long hole. But one bunker on the left and the two on the right. So you have to take a club that you're comfortable with putting the ball on the short grass and then second shot across the lake. And the pin today at 3, cut 25 on and just 5 from the right-hand side. Averaging 4.2, just 7 birdies. And that tier in our graphic there, right in front of the flagstick.
Pampling. With an iron.
Good swing. And that's the club, I reckon.
Shared the lead with Green. Now he's the outright leader at 4 under. This is Barnes playing his third shot.
Executed shot with the soft hands, plenty of spin on the ball once it got onto the dance floor.
On the tee at 3, Richard Green.
Just hitting the fairway metal. This will get further down, but he's caught that trap. And that's a very, well, not so difficult, but it's a testy shot because you've got the water to contend with. You've got to make sure you get all the ball.
Monster putt from Paul Gow. Picked up a shot early, gave it back. And now Stuart Appleby on the tee at 4. Also coming off a drop shot.
186 metres in the pin today. 10 on, 8 from the right. Tough pin to get at this one too. This hole's been lengthened by some 15, 18 metres.
Paul Gow has this for par at 3. He remains at 2 under, too shy of the leader, Rod Pampling.
So a couple of pars there for Mrs. Gow and Barnes. And Richard Green has had graphic shows in the bunker, pampling on the fairway. And a great shot from behind at what the players see here, and that back right pin is a difficult one to get at, particularly with the water on the right as well. Good thing though, as our wind gauge there, the Unisys wind gauge suggests, breeze from the left. And that's going to help you work the ball back towards the flag. So you don't want any heroics here. You want to hit it just into the middle of the green and try and ride it in on the breeze.
Oh, dear.
Gee.
I don't think that was saved by the duck.
Not only did it go right, it looked like he caught it a little heavy as well.
The pressure of the national championship.
I don't think Richard Green can get this to the green with that big lip in front of him. I think he's got to go way over here to the left, find himself some grass and try and chip and putt for four.
Very high, and he's on.
Oh, pretty brave shot there. Aimed it to the right. Up to the left, or his left, I should say. His left hand has always confused me, Sandy. I never know where to stand on the tee. Or it must annoy the hell out of left-handers because no one seems to know where to stand.
They'll take a break more shortly, the Australian.
Ball in the hole.
Come back to him in a moment, Jack. In the meantime, Stuart Appleby's second shot to the par 3 fourth.
Settle. Oof, dear, oh dear, that was very nearly in the bunker on the other side. So this will be Rod Pampling playing his fourth shot. Remember, a penalty for going in the water. That for a bogey five, so he's staring down the barrel of a double bogey here, so there's going to be a change at the top of the leaderboard, I think.
Stuart Appleby's having his problems too. This putt to save par, or chip I should say. Looks good, looks good.
Oh. Goalkeeper tipped it over the bar, looked in for all kind of money. That
we'll give it to him, but it's a shot gone.
Richard Green can two-putt this, and in a minute he could be in the lead. Well, that's a magnificent putt from where he was. Best part of 20 metres, that putt.
So he'll have that tap in to remain at 3 under.
And of course he's playing with Pampling, Sandy, so he's seen it all happen. He'd be saying to himself, gee, what's going on here?
Tell you what, there's a fair spring in his step, though, as he walked up after that putt. He knew it was good. He knows the situation.
He's not a prolific winner, but he's a prolific top tenner in Europe. This would be a massive breakthrough for him to win this.
While he's lining this up, Pat Welsh has found a special guest behind the third. Pat?
Sandy, I certainly have in Jack Regan, Managing Director of Hill Ross. Welcome. You couldn't hope for a better final day. Weather's good at this stage and we're looking for a great finish.
It's a tremendous tournament, isn't it, Pat? It's a wonderful golf course. It's the weather's as you say, it's just tremendous, and I think we're in for a good finish. It's a really tight leaderboard.
Real pleasure for your company too, I suppose, because this one's special. This one's the centenary.
Yes, there's only one of those. and we're delighted to be a part of it. It's a wonderful game, and we're really pleased to do our part for the promotion of Australian golf and Australian sport generally. It's a wonderful game, and it gives so much pleasure to so many people, and it's just fabulous to be a part of it.
Great way of entertaining your clients for the week too.
It certainly is. People really just do like it, and Sydney's been starved of top golf for a long time, and you know, to have so many people around Sydney come out and enjoy this is just tremendous. And can I just say, though, it's a wonderful experience for people sitting at home, because Channel 7 do such a fabulous job. My great thanks to you and to all the team at 7 and the production company. You guys are the best of the world at this, and you know, the commentary team and the production quality is just absolutely exceptional. So thank you very much for all you've done.
Hill Ross will be a marvellous host. We look forward to a great finish, Sandy.
Indeed we do, Pat. Richard Green has this putt for par. He's going to be our new leader after the drama that has surrounded Rod Pampling. Let's just put this in perspective. Green is at 3 under. He leads by 1. Gow and Pampling and Barnes are all locked together at 2 under par. All of a sudden, we have two shots separating the top 6 players.
And Alistair Presnell, who's playing the back 9 now, just 2 behind.
His dad would be looking down and be very, very proud of him. Ray, who sadly passed away, former captain at Huntingdale.
Absolutely. Big mover at the Huntingdale Golf Club. Done a great job.
To the 4th, the flyover courtesy of Hill Ross, and the pilot on this occasion is Captain Ogle.
Yes, some 37 metres added to this par 3. Wonderful hole, one of the signature holes here, and the pin today. We'll get straight into it. It's tough. Front right pin placement. Green's very firm. As you see there, just 6 birdies. And averaging just over its par of 3. But 186 metres across water. It is a brute of a hole. And I tell you, anything left of the flag. 2 putts, 3. Walk to the par 5, 5th. Very, very happy.
Ricky Schmidt was going remarkably well. Got it to 4 under, but then went bogey, bogey, bogey on 15, 16, 17. And finished with a round of 70, which is still a darn good effort. Finished 7 over for the week.
Let's have a look at Richard Green's statistics. 27 putts, 29 putts and 22 putts yesterday. That's excellent. Even for the par 3s, 4 under for the par 4s, and interestingly, particularly yesterday, the last 2 days, even par on the par 5s. 13 greens in reg, 10, 9. It's normally acceptable about somewhere between 13 and 15 is regarded as good to very good. Anyways, 8 out of 14 and 7 out of 14 in the second and third rounds. Probably not as good as he'd like it.
Might just wait for him for the moment. We'll get back to Richard and move ahead to Peter Lonard. Well, he needs to get something going. He's got a birdie opportunity here at 6.
He just can't get anything in the hole. Just feel if he could pick up a couple of birdies and get into that back 9 and get his teeth into this tournament, he'll be a hard man to beat. But you've got to hold the putts.
Ahead on Leaney on 7. This long birdie putt is 1 under and will remain on that score.
Yeah, you talk about greens in reg, Jack. Yeah. Peter Lonard, 13, 12 and 14. Great ball striking for the week on these very firm, smallish Australian Golf Club greens. Just cannot get the putts.
Changing times at the top of the leaderboard as far as the amateurs are concerned. Jason Day is heading towards home with a 4-shot lead over Nevin Bassick.
Very pleased to see how well Anthony Painter has progressed. Spent a bit of time up there at Royal Gunnedah. Nice little track in northwest New South Wales, and hasn't gone his way in this tournament, but he's really made his mark internationally.
Yeah, had a pretty sloppy year too, a 94th on the money list in the nationwide tour, and not one of his best years. Good player paints. Things just not going quite right for him this year. very likeable fellow. I know Wayne Smith and I have played plenty of golf with this fellow. He's a character out there. He certainly likes to have a few jokes and a few quips.
He slipped a two over for today's round, but has picked up birdies on 11 and also 14. So he's back to square with the card, and this would put him 6 shots from the lead if he can hold it.
Looks good. Break. Break. Oh, I cannot believe that didn't go right. So, par three for Anthony Painter. Two over today. Four over for the championship. Still very good scoring. Currently 20th position. Now Brad Hughes. This is the part of his game, really, that has let him down over the years. Remember, he was number one for Victoria when I was number one for New South Wales. And we had some great head-to-head matches. It's a good stroke. Well done. So two par threes from Painter and Hughes as they move to the number one hole. The 431-metre 16th is up after that one. And it's a tough hole, Gordon.
The breeze has picked up, the nor'easter, and there is prospects of a southerly change later to add to the spice of this tapestry.
Absolutely. Well, the wind's blown four directions this week, no doubt about that. It's been all over the place today, starting off out of the west and switching around to the nor'easter. And then later on, hopefully after 5:30, it'll be the southerly bluster that everybody's expecting. We just hope that that comes in later on. I'm sure Alistair Presnell will hope it comes in after he finishes the 18th. And the fella is scoring very well, although he's just dropped a shot, Alistair Presnell. Just dropped the 13th to be back to level par for the tournament. 3 under for the day. And a young fellow whose father was the captain at Huntingdale Golf Club died earlier this year, unfortunately. And now we pay our respects to the Presnell family. Great to see young Alistair playing well. Practices sometimes out of the Sandringham driving range. I see him a little bit. Great young kid with a very bright future. There's plenty of them around, Gordon, I can tell you. Young kids with bright futures in this country.
That is, to me, the standout feature of this Australian Open. The galleries are very good. They've come here to watch the homegrown talent, which has just performed spectacularly over the last 5 or 6 years.
Absolutely. No doubt about it. Gone are the days where we're paying $100,000 or $200,000 appearance money to these Americans that we really don't need out here and haven't proven anything at all. You have a look at it now, we have 11 players now inside the top 100 in the world, and a bunch from 100 to 200 in the world, and climbing. The US Tour next year will have 20 odd players teeing it up over there.
By the same token, Wayne Smith, board member of the PGA, absolutely thrilled that someone like Corey Pavin is out here for the right reasons.
Absolutely. Corey just got remarried too and was in Taiwan and decided to come out here and play, which Corey's always been a world traveller. And I know Wayne and I have played quite a bit of golf. Corey's a little bit older than me, about Wayne's age. Wayne's just a little bit older than me, but he's always been a great traveller, Corey, and a wonderful fellow.
He's a famous Australian golfer.
Yeah, you don't need to say too much about this fella, do you? The stocky stature of Craig Parry. And the one championship in Australia that has eluded this man is this Open Championship. Let's have a look at the flyover of the 15th. Tucked against Gardner's Road. That's the road to the left. And a wonderful par three. Today, playing slightly over the left shoulder and downwind. But the key to this hole is to pull the right golf club. You can't feel the breeze back on the tee because it's in the trees, but once the ball gets out here above the trees, it's very prone and susceptible to the wind. The breeze now switching around and coming in at about 11 o'clock as we're viewing the green, looking at it from here. And the golf club they'll be pulling right now would be 4 and 3 irons into this par 3. And I tell you, it's one of the tough holes on this back nine, as all of the par 3s are here at the Australian Golf Club. They're all long, narrow greens, except for the fourth, which is long and narrow and across you.
We're on the par 3 15th. This is 31-year-old Victorian David Branston. Started the day at plus 3.
Likes to move the ball right to left, so this pin is very good for him. He put golf on the map when TV was just starting out big time, and the flamboyant, loads of talent, flair, and that's why you had Arnie's army. They just flocked to see him, and the next guy to come along was the great man, Jack Nicklaus. But Arnold was really the man just after Ben Hogan's era in the 50s. And Arnold was just the man. I mean, I spent a little bit of time with him yesterday, had a good chat to him, and but he's interviewed out pretty much this week. He has just gone from pillar to post, the great man this week.
Wayne Smith and I were listening to him in the MasterCard tent yesterday, and he was talking away, for just reminiscing, really, and he said, am I boring you, to the fans? And you could have heard a pin drop.
I bet you.
Talk about a captivated audience.
Yeah.
Craig Parry, square for the card today. He started at plus 4, went out in 1 over 36, but managed a birdie on the 12th. So he's playing solid golf in this final round and looking at a good paycheck.
Well, he's done well, hasn't he? He was 3 over par after 4 holes. Started bogey, bogey, and then bogeyed the 6th, and then birdied 7, 9, 10, and 12, and a drop shot on 13. So a bit of a mixed bag for Paz. Great bunker player, this guy. He really knows how to get the ball up and down when he's around the greens. Fantastic touch. Plenty of green to work with here too, which is he's looking at the lie, so I would dare say that this is probably buried. This will come out with lots of topspin. He's got a lot of green to judge the roll to the flag. It is buried on the side slope too. Yep, look at this for touch. And he obviously couldn't go at the flag there either because of the lie.
You wouldn't mind transplanting those forearms, would you, of Popeye?
Oh, I already have, Gordon. They're my legs. Yeah, I never got called Popeye, did I? How about Stickman or One Iron with Ears? I've kind of grown up with through my career. Oh, I've got to live with that too.
Steve Conran, you mentioned him. He's in a group of 5 golfers at 1 under at the moment. Stephen Leaney, Allenby, Kurt Barnes and Paul Gower. Just 2 shots from the lead. So 7 golfers grouped within 2 shots. Then add Presnell and Lonard, who are square with the card. And the evergreen Roger Davis at plus 1 is just 4 from the lead.
There's over 12 guys within 5 shots of the lead. I tell you, you can make a quick double or triple on this golf course. Quick, smart, good. One wrong shot at the wrong time. Now watch David Branson here. This is a tough putt. Up the big ridge you can kind of see. 2/3 of the way between him and the flag. It'll be fairly flat, then it'll go right to left up the tier and then try to come back a little bit left to right at the hole. So a double breaker. Speed's the key. Ah, beautiful touch. Really good putt there.
So David Branston to finish up for his par on this par 3 15th. He's had a good tournament. A 1 under 70 on the opening day. A par out of 71 on Friday. And then just slipping with a 4 over 75 on Saturday, so starting the day at plus 3, and he's dropped 2 shots today.
Now Craig Parry sizing up his par putt.
Well done, Craig Parry. So he's one under for, or square with the card for today's round, and that was to save his par.
Now Branston is tidying up for his par three. Two different ways of making par there, Gordon.
Good up and down from Parry, and Branston benefiting from finding the dance floor.
And there is the leaderboard. Green and Pampling, both at three under. Leaney, Allenby, Barnes and Gow, all in the red, just two back. They're the only ones in the red.
Now, first of all, this was Terry Price. Remember this, a birdie putt at the second. And the man affectionately known as The Rock is absolutely wrapped. Stephen Bowditch can't win the Aprilia. That's already gone to Andre Stoltz. But here's his tee shot at the second. The first of the par threes on this Australian layout. And an absolute gem. Probably going even better, Jack, was Stephen Leaney on the same hole.
Yeah, this was the shot of the day for me so far. This pin is tucked right over near that bunker on the left. And that is absolute perfection from Stephen Leaney.
Robert Allenby needed to get a good early start. And here he is, birdie putt at two.
Coming off a drop shot at the first, gets it straight back at the second with that long putt.
That was a great putt. Paul Gow, no putter required at three. But, gee, Rod Pampling has just struggled at the start, hasn't he, Jack?
Yeah, he got away to a bad start today. Out of the trap here on the right of the first in the slope, taking it further away from the hole by the second.
Good news is that while we had our technical problems, we can bring you up to date. This was Pampling at four and his birdie attempt. Remember, he got a double bogey on three, so things are not looking at all good here. But this is a very good looking putt. It's bending back. Gets him back to three under. And a share of the lead with Richard Green. Stephen Leaney was another challenging. He has this birdie attempt at the eighth.
Already one under this to get to two under for the day. Beautiful putt from Leaney.
A couple of sensational long putts from the West Australian. Now we move ahead to the ninth. Remember, all this was recorded while we had our technical problems, so hopefully you're not missing any of the main action. This was for par for Leaney at nine. He'd got it to two under. Needed this to remain there. And slings it out of the hole.
Yeah. Drop shot at 9, out in 34. Par here, 71. 35 out, 36 back. But the way things are going at the top of the leaderboard, if you get anywhere in the red numbers and can go forward, it'll be a very testy afternoon. Alistair Presnell now. This for a birdie at par 5, 14th.
Now, that got him into red figures. We can update the leaderboard for you now, but he did give that back. It was 13, I think, and he dropped the shot at 14.
Yep.
So, here is the situation as it stands at the moment. Richard Green and Rob Pampling lead at three under par. Their nearest rivals are Kurt Barnes and Paul Gow at one under. There are now just four players under par. Presnell and Conran are at even par. So too Stephen Leaney, Peter Lonard and Robert Allenby. Villegas and Appleby have both struggled. They're at one over. Greg Chalmers, with that birdie and eagle on 13 and 14, has stormed into contention. Roger Davis is leading the veteran charge and doing it really well. He is a couple over. Stephen Bowditch, we've seen. Martin Doyle, we've seen. Both at three over par. These players, you would think, are out of contention. Anthony Painter, I mean, they're running out of holes anyway. Craig Parry is playing 16. David Branson and Paul Sheehan, both at plus five. Bradley Hughes and David McKenzie at plus six. So that brings us up to date with the leaderboard as it stands at the moment. And here we are, back with one of our co-leaders on the seventh tee, Rod Pampling at three under.
Well, Sandy, I can report that he's had pars at five and six, and had good genuine birdie putts as well. Nice crowd out following. Breeze starting to swing around towards the south. Now, remember, he smashed a monster down here of 308 metres yesterday.
And that's perfect. I think from the tee, he probably thought it was a bit too far right, like yesterday. He and Kurt Barnes both thought they were too far right. But it's in fact perfect because it's a blind tee shot.
This is Paul Gow. Putt at seven. Head in the green. This to get him to two under.
Struggling a bit with the putter, Paul Gow. Normally a good putter, makes a lot of birdies. Richard Green now at seven.
Yeah, they've both just steadied the ship a bit, Jack, after a nervous start, which was pretty bogey. And of course, Rod's double bogey. This one perfect from Richard Green as well. Not quite as far as Rod's, but a great position on the fairway over to the left hand side.
Stephen Leaney and his tee shot at 11. Par 3, 175 metres. And, pinned today, 7 on and 5 from the right.
Oh, that's a very good shot. Look where that pin is, just over that bunker. Very difficult to get it to stop.
And I can tell you that Alistair Presnell is back in red figures again because he's just scored a 2 on the 15th.
Gee, what a great round he's playing.
Fantastic. He's 4 under for the day, but this is Richard Green, joint leader.
...120 metres, got a great look at this flag. Just drifting a little left. Hang on to this green. Well, his short game, as he said yesterday, has improved dramatically. You would expect him to get that up and down.
Just over half the field back in the clubhouse. Only two players have broken 70, and those two players were out in the first two groups this morning. Stephen Jeffress and Pierre Fulke, both scoring 69.
Yeah, this breeze is getting pretty fluky, Sandy. That's why we're seeing the players a little unsure of what club to hit, plus the greens are getting firmer by the second. This is a great tee shot from Pampling. He's the pin today here, 31 on and 6 from the left. So being down the right, he's got a real good look at the flag. Caddy talking to him, trying to get him to stay calm but get cranked up.
Yeah, they work as a great pair, he and Simon. Just 106 metres.
Good tip for the club golfer here, Pat, how he stands behind the ball first, tries to get a mental picture of the shot he wants to play, then he moves in, but he's still not sure. He's questioning the breeze.
Well, Jack, that's exactly right. It is starting to gust now, and I can tell you that it's coming right to left across this seventh and just hurting him a little. So it's changing direction almost constantly. I hope that doesn't mean that the storm's on the way, because it is trying to get down to the south.
Yeah, southwest, Pat, I would suggest. So you're right, I think it is trying to get around to the south.
Breeze has died, Pamps is ready.
just 106. He started this right of the flag. Love the breeze to touch this a little more. Be happy enough with that, I think.
Brett, you know the wind here. Is that the case at the moment?
Well, I just stepped outside, Sandy, and there's seven flags. Four of them are blowing different directions. So it's not strong, but it is fluky, like Jack Newton said.
Yeah.
Now, Lonard. He just cannot make one. Listen to the frustration in him, too. Defending champion. He's still putting up a good fist of it, but he's been round level par every day. Just not firing. Ball striking has been great, but frustration on the greens.
And there you can see the five players that are in red figures. Green and Pamling. Wonderful performance by Alistair Presnell. Kurt Barnes hanging on, and so too Paul Gow playing the eight. With Rod Pamling at three under.
Didn't quite catch it how he wanted to, but we'll give him 7 out of 10.
You know who I'd like to be right now? Alistair Presnell. He pars 16 and then goes par birdie and posts 2 under par. Jack, how would you feel sitting in the clubhouse at 2 under?
Well, I suppose there's two ways of looking at it, Brett. You get in and post a score, but these fellas out here really have control of what's going to happen in the end. So it depends whether you, I guess from Alistair Presnell's point of view, he would have thought, well, if I can get in the top 10 today, that'd be a good effort. But now he's got a legitimate chance to win.
Pampling. This to lead by one. Short. Right in the heart. Down breeze putt there too. He would have thought that would have rolled on a little bit more. He's been rock solid after a pretty shaky start.
Yes, he remains at 3 under with Richard Green.
You want to talk about rock solid, Peter Lonard, 10 pars straight.
Retain a share of the lead.
Well, for mine, Richard Green looks more comfortable on and around the greens than anyone else. It's just a matter of whether he can hit the good shot at the right time, get a bit of a wriggle on, get some confidence.
Ahead to 11, Stephen Leaney, puzzled by that, looks quizzically at the ball, and he will remain square with the card so long as he taps that in.
Now, Paul Gow in the right rough, but it's not a bad place to come from. Well, we can't see his ball, but there's a gap there between the left-hand trap and the right-hand trap. If you can get a good piece of this, you can chase this on up the green. And just looking at that flag there now, it's certainly getting more round to the south. Down breeze that hole.
Ricky Barnes. Oh, Ricky Barnes. I did that yesterday. Excuse me. Sorry, viewers. How can I get an American mixed up with one of our top Australian kids, Kurt Barnes? Losing my concentration. I'm getting a little nervous.
You can't believe how far Barnes has hit it down here, Brett. Lob wedge. Straight down the flag with spin. Another birdie chance.
That's a beauty. It nearly jumped in the hole too, Ray, I can tell you, on a second bounce. Beautiful shot.
Lonard now on the tee at 11.
This pin on 7 and 5 from the right. Gee whiz. You've just got to put this left of the flag and try and give yourself a 5 or 6 metre putt for a birdie.
Oh.
You can't hit a better shot than that. That is as good as it gets.
Maybe
where that flag is.
Par run could come to an end, Jack.
Well, we've been saying for 3 days he's due to make a putt, but nothing happening.
That was an awesome shot to get that ball that close, Jack.
175 metres, and you've got 7 metres of green to pitch it in.
Well, while they're at the eighth there at the moment, let's take a quick flyover, courtesy of Hillross, Jack.
Yeah, this hole in years gone by was a par five, but it's been a par four for some time now. And the key here is where the breeze is coming from. And now, as these players approach the eighth, Kurt Barnes was way up here past the 300 metre mark. And the pin just tucked quite tight to that left hand trap. If you get cute with it and don't get it right, you're in the bunker and a very difficult shot. Not too many birdies here, although with the breeze now helping these guys, the distance they hit it, going in there with quite short clubs, even though the hole measures 405 metres.
That's right, Jack. This breeze continue to swing around. It is helping them now. And 247 to get it past the trap on the left-hand side. That was always on the safe side of the fairway, over to the right, probably bounding 25 metres past that trap.
Well, here's the opportunity for Peter Lonard to break the run of pars. This to move into red figures, and this for a share of third place.
Left lip, Sandy. Got it.
Finally.
Don't believe it.
The defending champion is still well and truly in the hunt. Just two shots off the pace.
Back to eight. Richard Green. They love it. Tee behind. And a beauty. Good two drives there, both down the right side to attack that flag.
Let's move ahead to the green. Jack?
Paul Gow, yeah, he came from the rough and not able to get any spin on the ball. All the way down the slope. And a pretty good lag putt from where he was.
It's moved way ahead to the young Victorian Alistair Presnell, who's going great guns. Third shot here at this tough par 4, 16th, number one hole on the card. As good as he could have done from there. I felt if he can make that putt and make four on this hole, and then pass 17 and put a birdie on 18, and the weather changes, as Jack has talked about before.
Kurt Barnes in the meantime for outright third.
Big putt.
Just to go two under. No.
Read it to come left, but he just hit it through the break. We've spoken about that before. When you're putting, you have to choose whether you're going to be one of those people who hits the putts firmly, or conversely, a putter who dives the ball in the hole, and consequently the selection of line is a different an approach.
I said it earlier in the week, Jack. I'll say it again, he does remind me of a young Long John Daly.
Yeah, there's an awful lot of raw talent there, Sandy. And look, I suppose from most people, you know, who's this Kurt Barnes? But he won the 2002 Australian Amateur. They don't give you those.
No.
So the guy can genuinely play golf.
And then what, shoots 29 under 2 weeks ago at Emerald Lakes.
Mm. Oh, there's a lot of talent. Rod Pampling was telling me last night that he was very impressed with him. Just needs a little bit of tightening up with his short game. He's particularly, his shots from sort of 80, 90 metres to 120 metres. He just felt that that was the part of his game he needs to improve. He said he's a good putter.
Do you know the Muzzlebrook course, Jack?
Yeah, it's a good country golf course.
He shot 60 on that.
With creeks that you've got to contend with around there. And we've had a lot of good young players come out of Muzzlebrook. Good junior program, which I think is very important in any golf club. You've got to have some juniors around. You've got to have some young people.
Speaking of youngsters, Jason Day has birdied the last to shoot a round of one over par 72. he will be the leading amateur. And there is a young man with a future, Jack.
Oh, he's a very good-looking player. Flushes it. Now, Richard Green needs to flush this.
Yes, Jack, just caught the rough, so he's a fair way back. He's still got 166 metres here, and this one looks like it may be just a little short. Not going to kick up that hill. Again, though, I repeat, very comfortable with his short game at the moment.
Just looking at that flag, the breeze looks like it's done a 360. You might be right, Brett.
Well, as you said a while ago, Jack, it is everywhere. It's hard to pick. Now, Paul Gow, tough tee shot this. You don't want to miss this fairway, left or right.
And you need to flush it. It's 420 metres.
It's going left.
Billy wiped Uncle Radar out.
We couldn't stand to lose those shorts.
He's caught a good lie, though, boys. Very lucky, actually. He's got a gap. He can get to the green from there.
We're watching Rod Pampling, about to play his second of the par 4 eighth.
Great drive, and Jack, you're right. Now the breeze, I think, is hurting them a little. Very, very fluky at the moment. 33. Left, oh. Well, that wasn't the play, was it? You always had to be right at that flag. Take the trap out of play.
You're dead right, absolutely. Good play here. Iron for the Longfellow. Sun headed down left centre, I would say. That's good, though.
Former two-time winner Aaron Baddeley has finished with a 2-over par 73 to finish 7-over for the championship.
Now, Alistair Presnell with a big putt here for safe par. He's got it. What a four from where he was.
Now, that is a big, big putt.
He was over in Tunstall Avenue.
What can Stuart Appleby do here at nine? He's got to get something going too.
Oh, all happening suddenly.
The moves maybe are about to start. They say it all starts with just nine to play, Jack. But with this fluky breeze, I mean, who knows what's the weather doing. The sooner we get to Melbourne for some nice, consistent weather, Jack, you'll be happy.
You're kidding, aren't you?
Please, Sandy, I'm with Jack. Stop dribbling.
Let's take a break. Here at the moment, it is currently 39 degrees. And no signs of cooling down. But I tell you what else has happened is that we have now a very, very exciting golf tournament with a couple of major names starting to make a move. That's the ball of Richard Green, who currently has a share of the lead at 3-under. But Lonard getting finally a much-needed birdie, moves into red figures. Kurt Barnes is still there. Paul Gowjack is still there.
Absolutely great chip we just saw then from Richard Green. Now look at this shot here. Kurt Barnes has got to take this way out to the right of this overhanging branch and try and turn it back, or he'd get taken under the branch.
Must turn it right to left, Kurt. Didn't like the play off the tee. Iron brought that pine into play. Yeah, back edge. Really good shot. About as good as he could have done.
That's a very tough putt from there. Tough two putt.
Co-leader Rod Pampling playing his third to the par 4 eighth.
About as good as he could do from there, because from the edge of the bunker there down to the flag, it's all downhill. He short-sighted himself, pulling that in the trap.
Paul Gow, this is a tough shot.
Gowie got lucky off the tee there. Ball sitting up really, really nicely. Fine-looking shot. Oh, great birdie opportunity here by the looks of things.
Oh, radar.
To go one behind.
Radar about 12 feet right of the stick and pin high. Sensational shot from Paul Gow.
Pampling. Big putt this one. This for par. to retain a share of the lead. He misses.
Pulled it. Knew it had missed as soon as it came off the putter.
Two shots separating six players. Green the leader by one from Pampling. Then Presnell, Lonard, Barnes and Gow. And if Alistair Presnell just keeps it together, he's going to be sitting in the clubhouse saying, well, come on home, boys. I'm waiting.
Hey, 4-4 is going to get him a very fat check, thank you.
My word. Very fat.
Now Lonard finally got it in the red. Second shot here at 12. Pin back left. Perfect angle to attack this stick. Whoa. Boy, these greens certainly firming up. That first hop was about 8 metres.
Here's Alistair Presnell then. Second to 17. Little bit of flirting going on there, but he's okay. Now, Brett, take us for a Hillross flyover of 9.
Yeah, beautiful golf hole. Been lengthened some 13 metres with a new tee here, the normal tee just to the left. Dunks hill to the right here, that's the key to this hole. But if you avoid that, you don't want to go left either because you have that big pine tree just left of the bunker there that blocks you out, as we saw Kurt Barnes and Paul Gow. Once you've negotiated the fairway, pin today, pretty sedate really, front left, doesn't make the hole play all that long. And as you see there, 7 birdies, averaging 4.25. All in all, this is a wonderful, wonderful par 4, very, very strong. Drive the key.
On.
Going left. And he will have to negotiate not only a tough bunker shot, but he has that pine tree about 15 metres in front of him.
Now a big putt for Kurt Barnes all the way down this green, given that the pin's cut front left. Can he get the speed right? That's the big question. Has he hit it? Has he hit it? Well, a pretty good putt really from where he was.
Rod Pampling on the tee at 9.
And there's my boat.
He's got to be very disappointed. I mean, making bogey from 133 centre of the fairway at the last one, but this is perfect. Split the centre.
Yeah, position A, Pat. And despite the heat, the gallery's out in force. That's great to see on this Sunday afternoon in Sydney. Paul Gow to get to 2 under. Trying to join his good mate Rod Pampling and Peter Lonard.
And long backstroke and decelerated on that one, Sandy. Still good outward half, still well in the mix.
Now have a look at this. Peter Lonard is just off the cut surface. An outside chance to go to 2 under. And moved within one shot of green. He's got it, and the defending champion is one off the pace.
Makes nothing all week, and then he goes bang, bang, right when it counted.
The man they call Plod.
And they'll fire him right up too, Brett, those two birdies.
Presnell for birdie. I think really love to just make 4 here. And he's going to have a little knee shaker for a par. Makes that. Birdie's the last, or maybe Eagle's the last. It is reachable. I've been watching a few players on 18. Boy, oh boy. Hotting up, Sandals.
A break. We shall take, and more shortly from the Australian. 39, the Metropolitan Course in Victoria. Welcome the biggest names in golf for the Australian Open. A year that will become Jack Newton's finest hour, filled riddled with names like Nicholas, Player, Ballesteros, and the 77 Open champ, David Graham. The halfway mark, another rise, Greg Norman, led by 4 shots. And people were wondering, was it going to be his year? Well, it wasn't Greg's. On the final day,
Newton produced an amazing round. Holing out from off the green, no more than three times to finish at even par at the end of the 72 championship holes. And with Norman missing his putt, Jack Newton proudly held his first and only Australian Open title.
The juniors all over Australia get benefit out of that, as well as diabetes.
Now, as I mentioned earlier, Richard Green in the bunker, that big pine tree, 15 metres, got to punch it under the branches. They punched it out well. I can tell you, his pin cut short left. He's got his work cut out to get that up and down for par.
Well, the graphic tells the story. Beautiful tee shot, 126. Again, just misjudging the breeze, which is seemingly all over the place at the moment.
Robert Allenby has this for par at 11, an important putt for him because he's coming off a birdie at 10. Oh, again, that just shaves the hole. But it's a drop shot. The birdie at 10 is wiped out. He's only three shots off the pace.
Here we go. To Peter Lonard. Just six birdies for the week for Lonard and four bogeys. There's a tricky one. And each of the 3 days prior, he has parred the last five holes on every day.
But the bad news for his competitors is that two of those six birdies have come in the last 5 minutes. He may be on some sort of a roll.
Great shot.
Classy shot there from Richard Green. Not an easy one, playing to the green that was above him.
Gow at the Amiga hole, the 10th.
Three metal from the tee. No value in the driver, gets very narrow. Bunkers down the right. And he's looking right. Has he found the first of the two bunkers on the right? Yes. Well, I think he's playing the wind to be more downwind, and it's more across, I think.
Back at nine, third shot for Rod Pampling.
Oh, flubbed it.
Well, that's what he was worried about yesterday, was his chipping. I think he's just a bit quick on them, Brett. You know, he doesn't seem to be taking the club back far enough and giving it a bit of a right-hand jerk.
Kurt Barnes with an iron. He's going left. Needs a lucky break over there. And depends on his backswing. Overhanging Melaleuca.
Now, Pampling. This for par. So there's another one gone. And all of a sudden, he's two shots off the pace.
Well, they're two bad bogeys, it's the only thing you can say. From where he was, he drove the ball beautifully at 8 and again here at 9. 120 and a smidge to the flag, down breeze at 8.
Tell you what, there's a spring in the step of Peter Lonard that has returned.
Yeah, but you wait till you see the shot he has here, though. This comes... This is down breeze, across a big mound in the middle of the green, and then picks up speed. And I can tell you, I know Jack will back me up on this, touch of a surgeon required.
And a huge swing from left to right. That's why he's hawking it. He's really trying to get a feel for the shot, and he's going to chip it.
Now for those at home, just watch this, okay? I want you to take note. The ball will be back in the stance, legs close together. I see too many amateurs with their feet wide apart. Big, fleeting swing. Watch this. He probably has a little wedge, back of the stance, and it's just a miniature putting action. No leg movement. Back in the stance, you can see the ball. Smooth little arm and hand movement. That's it. got to stop.
Saddle. Pretty darn good from there.
Oh, class shot.
Yeah.
And importantly, leaving himself an uphill putt for par.
Richard Green for 4 on 9. Needs this one.
Oh. I tell you what, this leaderboard is changing that quickly at the top. It's very hard to keep up.
Well, the Centenary Open Sandals deserves it. Truly. 100 years, and I tell you what, they are playing like it's the 100th. Boy, oh boy, who wants this championship?
I think we asked the same question, what, in 85?
There's been many a year we've come to the back nine, and who wants to win the Stonehaven Cup?
So Green is at 2 under. Let's just clarify this. Lonard is at 2 under. Presnell, Barnes, Pampling, and this man, Paul Gow, all at 1 under par.
Yeah, that's a very difficult shot from that bunker. Oh, dear. Umpire Bailey signals wide. He's turned it over on the wind. And that is dead.
One word, Jack, exactly right. Dead.
I must say, you've lengthened umpire Bailash's career over the years, Jack. It's Kurt Barnes.
He's lucky he had a backswing. He's thrown it up nice and high. Oh, no, not in there.
Oh, what's going on?
Well, he's got a flyer out of the rough, Sandy. It probably looked good to him in the air, but it just went too far. And that's dead, too.
Yeah. Is a big putt right now. It's a left to right putt. It's uphill. But this, as we all know as golfers, is a right-hander's nightmare, left to right. Got to concentrate on the speed and line.
Right when he really, really needed to make a putt.
Richard Green finds himself again, alone, at the top of the leaderboard.
And that's just Peter Lonard's 5th bogey of the week.
What about this shot? He's got to take it up over the top of this paper bark. No green to work with and try and get it to stop. Pretty good shot. Pretty good shot from where he was.
Is it going to be shades of 1982 when Bob Shearer was the only one to come home under par? Alistair Presnell could find himself in the clubhouse in exactly that situation.
Now, Kurt Barnes, we saw over the back. Somehow he's got it on the green. I thought he was unplayable. This for par. If someone can just string some pars together here, you win the Australian Open.
Third shot for the young Victorian, Alistair Presnell, drove it in the bunker off the tee, here for 2 on this par 5. This is 3rd. Pin cut short, or middle right, you do not want to be right. Oh, he's got a flyer. Clunk. It's all happening. Nail-biting stuff, this.
Now, Paul Gow. There in 3. Can he chip this in? He chipped in at the first. This to save par.
Should there be a playoff, the players will start on 18, then 17, back to 18 and continue at 18.
And it's certainly looking that way, Sandy.
Final 14th here for Peter Lonard. Can he get a big tee shot away? To be going a little right. There it is in the rough. Very difficult to keep it out of that right-hand rough because of the camber on the fairway, kicking the ball to the right.
Critical time for Paul Gow. He could and will drop out of a share of 2nd spot. Oh, more than that.
I've seen him do that a number of times. Just shove it to the right. Usually that means you're not keeping your body in your head still.
a double bogey, and from one under to plus one. Now.
He knows it too. That's a bad time to make a bad error.
Four players in red figures.
Make that three in a minute. Barnes for bogey. Back to level par.
Ahead to Alistair Presnell.
That little square you saw there, that was the drop zone. Whoop, steady.
Well, he's got that to save par. But it's been a magnificent round of golf. That will be for a 67. We'll see him finish in just a moment.
Especially when you're playing alongside Jeff Ogilvie. He's had a horror day today. As we take a look at the balls of Richard Green and Pampling. Richard Green to play first.
Jeff Ogilvie, five over.
Lovely rhythm on that swing. Well, he was on the fairway and he misjudged that. So that's why Kurt Barnes went over the back.
Pampling.
This is where they say it all starts to happen. Back nine, last day. Rod Pampling needs to change things around off the back of a couple of bogeys. This looks great.
Nothing wrong with that at all, Pat.
A little unlucky for Pampling there.
Lonard from the right rough at the par 5, 14th. Steady. Greenside bunker, though. Not a bad miss, although not a lot of green to work with.
Kurt Barnes on 11. 175 metres, pin today, 7 on, 5 from the right.
Don't hit it. Don't touch it.
Oh. How about that putt? I don't think he can get that near the hole with the putter. Slope off the shoulder of the bunker there. You might have to chip that.
Pull out.
Shot a final round, even par 71 today. He finished four over for the championship, so another national title eludes him for another year.
Richard Green from the fringe using the putter. It's gone off in his hand. A little bit surprising he putted that as good as he chips.
Here's a big putt, Jack, for Alistair Presnell. This is for par.
Just imagine, you're a young guy, and you think if you make this, you might win the Australian Open.
He's got it.
Oh, no. That's disappointing. A six at the last for a round of 68, but still an excellent week for Alistair Presnell. He finishes three under for the day and even for the championship. Well played.
There'll be both relief and disappointment with that.
Pampling. This will be, I'll call this, it's pretty straight. It might try to move a little bit to the right. Inside left, you'll start this. If it hasn't got speed, it'll drift to the right of the hole. Beautiful angle. Pulled it. Always left off the putter face, that. I don't know, it cut spins them, doesn't he, Jack? It's...
I do like that angle. I know you do too, Brett.
Oh, I love low angles like that on putting greens.
A worm's eye view. You can see it all happening.
Can you even see the grass growing? Big putt for this guy, right here.
With all this drama going on, Sandy, I'm only going to go for a playoff now.
Well, I don't think it'll be far off the mark, and it'll start on 18, then go to 17, then back to 18. Three players in red figures.
What about a five-way playoff?
that a bit stupid?
I don't think so.
We'll be here till tomorrow.
Come on, Greeny. Pretty straight. Got it.
Oh, did a lap, but he's got it.
You almost called that too early, Sandy.
Well, he leads by one, but I tell you what, you can almost feel a tension at the moment, this championship. There are so many different ways it can go, and if you haven't got sweaty palms or the hair in the back of your head isn't standing up, perhaps you're very bald.
Not a lot of pleasantries being exchanged out there just at the moment.
She is tight, she is tough. And this course is giving nothing away. A break, and we'll be back to continue our coverage of the Hillross Australian Open. 12 players, and you'd have to suggest that any one of those 12 could win.
Barnes, tough two putt from here, as Jack Newton said earlier.
Go!
And he left himself just over a metre for his par three.
Peter Lonard is one of just three players in red figures. He's one under. Lonard and Pampling trailing Green by a shot at 14. Is it going to be shades, Jack, of 1982 when Bob Shearer, the only player under par, 287 he scored, to beat Payne Stewart and Jack Nicklaus, who finished at plus three?
Could very well be, Sandy. That breeze is definitely getting up. Paul Gow gets one in at last. So he's back in there with a show.
Well, he punched the putter enough in the last two holes. Maybe shook it up and took notice.
When he chucked it in the bag there on 10.
Barnes.
The big problem from Kurt is he's left himself those nasty length putts to make right from the first hole to save par. And when you're trying to will them in the hole, they don't tend to go in.
Lonard, this for birdie.
Could be decisive, this putt, Brett.
I reckon so, Jack. Left lip, downhill. Got it.
Well done. Joins Richard Green at the top of the leaderboard. The defending champion making a move on the back nine.
He looks the man at the moment to me, really. Lonard, he's making the birdies at the right time.
Well, Richard Green's carried the lefty's hopes, and he's still there at 11. Par 3, 175 metres.
In that little gully off to the left. Not an easy shot, although pitching back into the breeze. Tried to draw the ball in.
And now Pampling.
A tough pin for Pamps. Pin front right. Likes to move the ball right to left. The only saving grace is the breeze is off the left, so he could hold it up with his draw. Well, good shot, but no spin.
The best round of the day belongs to young Victorian Alistair Presnell, a 68, a fantastic finish. Here he is with Pat.
Yes, and Sandy has kindly waited around while I ran all the way back from the 10th. Congratulations, well done. And I know you're a little bit disappointed with that bogey at the last, but I tell you what, you're right in the mix.
Yeah, I was quite surprised by the round. It worked out all right, so very happy with it.
Talk us through the round, and 16, very important. That's going to claim a lot of scalps as the afternoon goes on.
16, yeah, it's a tough hole. It's been tough all week. Fortunately, I made a par on it. Won't comment on how I did it, but it was very nice to roll the putt in.
Okay, now, you've got a flight to Hong Kong tonight. You've got a heavy schedule. You're still trying to keep your card up in Asia. And you were telling me this is your first ever major event in Australia. It's the National Open, and you've played sensationally well.
Yeah, surprisingly, very happy with it. It qualified on Monday, so it was nice to get in and then to make the cut even better, and nice way to finish off the day.
How do you spend the afternoon? Do you go to the locker room? Do you watch the television?
I wish I was going to the beach, to be honest. But yeah, I guess I'll just have to do that.
First things first, you may be lifting the Stonehaven Cup a little later on. There's a lot of disasters happening out there at the moment.
I'm not sure. I think the big boys will be able to pull it in, but we'll see.
Oh, you're going to be very proud of the way you played this afternoon. And I know your dad, who was a great mate of Sevens, he was the captain of Huntingdale, wasn't he, for years?
Mm. Yeah, no, sadly passed away earlier this year. I'm sure he was with me the whole way, and it was very nice.
Yeah, he would have been too. I know he was a great supporter. All right, well done today. Fine round, and we'll keep our fingers crossed for you.
Thank you. Thanks.
Yes, I wouldn't suggest he heads to the beach just yet. Fine young man, and well played. 68 in the final round of your national title, playing it for the very first time. Great effort.
Yeah, I'm so happy for him. He hits balls at Sandringham Driving Range in Victoria.
There was a bit happening while we were chatting to him.
Richard Green.
This green is 32 metres long, and the pin's on 7, so if my maths is right, he's probably got something of the order of 20-plus metres here. Putt. Oh, that's a very good lag putt from there.
Ahead. Tough par three, this one. Pin cut just over the tier on the left-hand side and breeze off the left.
Lonard has parred it every day so far.
3-iron in hand, guys. Just to the right of the flag, drawing in lovely. Looks the perfect club. He's in the driving seat, guys.
That's what I reckon too, Radar. And that's a great tee shot.
What about Richard Green here? This is his third shot. He tried to play a bump and run up the bank. Missed the bank. Oh, great shot, recovery. But he's going to drop at least one.
And it's going to leave the defending champion alone at the top.
He looks the guy that's got the momentum suddenly going for him. Some of these other guys look like it's a real battle, which it is round here.
Haven't they backed up on the weekend, though? 8 under par leading after 36 holes and really looking like maybe 10 to 12, as we said at the start of the week, Jack, would win the championship. Have a look at this. 2 under may well win.
Gavin Coles had a good round today of 70 to finish 1 over. Peter Senior is 76. He finished at plus 8. Richard Green to keep the damage to a minimum. It's a shot gone. Lonard is at 2 under. Green and Pampling at 1 under.
And the tough thing about today too, and the tough thing about the 4 days here, is the wind has blown 4 different directions. The guys started out early in the week with a southerly, and that's what they were predominantly practicing in. And then all of a sudden, the wind swung around Thursday to be different. Friday again was similar to Thursday, but Saturday yesterday was different. And today, they've had more of a westerly, nor'wester, which has thrown them again. That's why their scoring is tough.
Yeah, a lot of crosswind shots, Brett, which is tough to play in. If most of the pros would suggest down breeze or straight into the breeze, much easier.
A break, and more shortly at the Australian. Winner last week in the New South Wales, and he has this putt to try and stretch his lead to 2.
Well, the thing with Peter, I think, is that even though he hasn't putted well, he'll par you to death because he just keeps on hitting good shots, and that's what's really required now, particularly over these closing holes, as we've mentioned it all week, 15, 16, 17, all difficult holes. 18, a bit of a breather, that chance at a birdie. This for a two at 15. Got it.
Oh, what a putt. He now leads by two. The defending champion showing his class when it counts.
The only thing, he hasn't been in contention this year. Can he hang on?
Look at the reaction here. He's watching this like a hawk. He knows, Jack, it's right on track.
As soon as he struck it. But Brad, he won last week, so surely that's going to give him some confidence.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I meant a major kind of title, but yes, he did win the New South Wales Open.
Time for a flyover, Jack, over 12. That's where they're heading.
Yeah, well, 12, of course, 385 metre par 4. Don't need you've got to stay out of these traps. That's the key to it. And the new tee gives you more of a dog leg to contend with. And I always found this hole very difficult to judge a second because the green's set above you and you can't get a feel for where the flag is. That ridge also comes into play there. Averaging just over its par of four, there's been 11 birdies. I don't think I ever birdied this hole in my life. But I think now these guys have got to recognise that Peter Lonard's going forward. They better get the handbrake off or he's going to snatch it from underneath their noses.
Another Drano. Well done, Gowie. All of a sudden, Paul Gow with two super putts in a row. Making a late run.
Now on the tee at 12, Richard Green.
Wind off the right.
Trapped. So that's finished in the trap.
Tee shot finding the sand. So if you've just joined us, let's just clarify the situation. Lonard is at 3 under, Richard Green and Rod Pampling, his nearest rivals, at 1 under par.
Stephen Leaney. A good shot. Right in the middle of the green. But there's a tier there which will drag the ball back further away from the hole.
Now Paul Gow, fresh off birdie, after a double on 10. Turning it over. Easy. Well, that for me is a bad play. 230 metres to that bunker, and all as you need is an iron short of it, and you have a 9-iron home. Tried to get aggressive and tried to put it up in a very narrow section of that fairway. Yeah. May pay the price.
Lonard may lead, but don't discount someone like Stuart Appleby with a couple of par fives to come. He's only 3 shots off the pace. This tournament is still wide open. News. Our leader is Peter Lonard, the defending champion. He's playing 16 and he leads by 2.
And has made 4 on this hole every day so far, Sandy, which is a big, big feat.
I tell you.
You didn't miss that either. Good tee shot.
Poor positions for two players trying to chase him home. Messrs. Green and Pampling at the par 4 12th. I can tell you Roger Davis has just finished his round, a round of 70. That's a great effort. Finished 1 over for the championship.
Great performance from the Dodger.
Second shot up the hill. Doesn't like it. Pulled it to the right. Not too bad. Pins on the top shelf. Two-tiered green this, so he probably thinks it's even further than just over the back of the green.
Well, Pamps has got a swing.
and a look at the green, but he's got to keep it low off a very sandy lie. Oh, this is spearing right, and it's headed for the trap. And he's got a very, very long trap shot from up here.
That's what he's got left, and that is no easy shot by any stretch of the imagination to get the distance right.
Kurt Barnes now has dropped back to one over. Playing 13.
Spin.
Oh, woo.
Not left. Spin back, I thought. Big putt for him coming up there. With, you can nail one of those. A couple of par fives to come.
Second shot to Lonard at 16.
Straight down it, Sandy. Is it the club? He's walking after it. He loves it. Little long, but fine shot on this hole. He's pumped, let me tell you.
That's pure adrenaline radar, I reckon, that made that go long. But he didn't want to be short, that's for sure. It's amazing how when the adrenaline starts pumping through your body, how much further you can hit the ball. And you've got to be careful of it, because when you'd normally say hit an 8-iron 160, suddenly, you know, it goes 170 and you fly it over the back of the green. That's just pure adrenaline.
To 12. Pampling's third shot. Tough bunker shot, this one. He's got to get up the ridge. Just gets on top. But he's frittering away shots, Rod. He really needs birdies.
Paul Gough from the left-hand trap. Tough shot. I suggest this will be right of the flag. When it's dry here, that ball would have rolled all the way back down the bottom of the hill. Because we've had quite a lot of rain here in the last few weeks. Now Richard Green, who's chipped the ball beautifully all week. Probably goosed there a little bit by chipping back into the breeze. He probably thought it might hold it up a bit, but you can see the colour of those greens starting to get that, well, I guess a brown look. Suggests they're drying out, getting pretty firm.
This one is a must putt. Got to stay at one under. 13's a definite birdie chance. 14, the par five, is a definite birdie chance. 15, maybe. Lonard did. 16, tough. 17's a chance, and 18 is a chance. So there's not too many really good chances left on this golf course. So this is a must par putt for Pampling.
Knock it in. A bit like Kurt Barnes, left himself with a lot of that length putt to save par, and under the gun, playing for the Centenary Open. Not what you need.
So Pampling now joins Presnell, Bowditch and Appleby at even par.
This will test his touch, Lonard. It comes down the tier now. How's the speed? Looks pretty good.
Oh, an excellent leave.
That's terrific. He's made four straight fours on this 16th, and it's played at 4.5, 4.6 and 4.7 throughout the week.
He just looks in control, Jack. He's pretty calm. He looks in control.
It's amazing for me how he can putt so incredibly, I won't say bad, but indifferently, and then suddenly he nails one, and it all comes together, and away he goes.
Richard Green, a has spent a considerable amount of the afternoon either in the lead on his own or sharing it. That's a fine putt.
That's a great save.
Now two shots behind Peter Lonard.
Paul Gow now from short of the green at 13. Awkward little shot. Well done. Bit of a tester now for Parvo down that slope.
Peter Lonard is on the verge of joining a select group. Only four other players have won the Australian Open in successive years. For Hill Ross Australian Open is concerned, this is when there's won and lost. But let's go back with our Dodo update at some of the highlights of the day, and it has been an exciting day. Gow, Paul Gow with his third shot to three. Early in the day, no putter required. Rod Pampling playing his second to the fourth. Look at the length of this putt, Jack.
Went in like it had eyes, Sandy, didn't it? A little kick off the spike mark, in.
Unbelievable. Stephen Leaney now at eight. At one stage, really did threaten. From Stephen Leaney on eight to Peter Lonard and his tee shot at 11. Par 3, 175 metres.
Oh, this was a great shot at the right time, as Peter Lonard inevitably does.
Alistair Presnell, this par putt at 16 when he really needed one, and gets it all over the shop on 16.
One of the stories of this week's Australian Open.
Well, he and Kurt Barnes, they're the two stories as far as our young players go.
Peter Lonard at 12. Ah, yes. Finally, Paul Gow, tee shot. Again at this par 3, 11.
This was a class shot too. The right club, the right shape of shot and good spin on it.
Fresh off a double bogey, two jack on 10. Step up and hit a good shot. And then, after missing a couple of putts on 9 and 10, Reno. Center cut.
To the 14th, and Lonard out of the bunker.
Breeze got up just as he played it. You could see that flag really fluttering. And this was a shot for Richard Green from down in this little miniature valley of sin, you might say. Had to run it. Didn't have a good enough lie to pitch it. And chipped it all the way over the green in the bunker on the other side.
At 15, Peter Lonard had a birdie opportunity. Chance to stretch his lead. And he did. And finally, Paul Gow. Birdie attempt at 12. Desperately trying to keep his hopes alive to win his first Australian title. He's still there, but he trails Lonard by two. Now, this is interesting. This is Stephen Bowditch at 18. His third shot, and it's going to be interesting to see how he finishes.
He's birdied 17.
So he's got a little mini run going here, and he'll have that for another birdie putt. And a birdie-birdie finish would be very, very interesting.
Here's the 13th. Run you through it. A very short par 4.
Tee shot of Richard Green.
Yes, in the middle of the fairway.
Pin just 8 on and 5 from the left, so that bunker on the left staring you in the face. And it's considerable up incline, rather, to negotiate in here. Always difficult to get the distance right. settle. Good chance at a three there because he's running up the hill.
Now let's go back to 18. There are a lot of things surrounding this particular putt, because if he gets this, he finishes in red figures. And as far as Alistair Presnell is concerned, he'll be able to go to the beach.
It's a tough putt though, Sandy. Down a tier, left to right. Speed very important.
This for a birdie finish?
No.
He's got it. Stephen Bowditch is in the clubhouse at one under par.
Bodhi, you beauty.
A round of 69.
Well, you said early in the day, Brett, he was averaging something ridiculous, wasn't he, with the putter?
24.6 putts he averaged this week.
Well, he's brought it home in 32 on the back nine. Nobody's been able to tear that back nine up all week. A round of 69.
Well, is this going to be some finish? I should clarify too, if it is a playoff, it's 18-17, 18-17, and on in that order.
Second shot for Lonard at 17.
Five iron, Jack. Looks to be going a little long, middle of the green. Didn't even think about the flag. Yeah, it's just running over the back. Needs an up and down.
Oh, look at that pin. 23 on and just four from the left-hand side.
Pampling. Very, very quick putt. This for birdie. Right now, really needs this. But it is a very slick putt. Get there. Well, it got there, it just didn't break. Which I expected it to go a little bit more to the right. He must be so frustrated inside, Rod Pampling.
I mentioned only four players have won back-to-back national titles here in Australia. Gary Player did it twice. Jack Nicklaus, Greg Norman, and of course the last man did it once as an amateur, Aaron Baddeley. So Peter Lonard would join a very select group.
Now Richard Green at three over for the round, one under for the tournament. Good shot at a birdie here. And you'd have to think that he's got to get something happening here pretty quickly. This for birdie at 13. Good putt, just dive right across the face of the hole. Well, par five coming up, so perhaps a shot at a birdie there, which would get him within one of Lonard.
Well, here's someone who we probably shouldn't forget about, Stuart Appleby. He's in red figures. He's at one under, has this putt for par, remains at one under, trailing by two.
That six at 10, really.
Yeah.
Sorry, five at 10 didn't help him.
Lonard, third shot. Oh, he's played it beautifully. Get in, he's going to hole it. Oh, you're joking.
That could be it.
Peter Lonard,
four under par, and he may join those four players in the last 50 years to make it back-to-back Australian Open victories.
The cream always rises to the top.
Here it is again. Take us through it, Jack.
Yeah, just a little forearm jolt with the wedge, sand wedge. And it could never look like missing. Popular guy in Sydney here, huge following. I know my dear old mum, who'd be sitting at home watching this, will be loving seeing Peter Lonard do what he's doing here on the back nine.
In the meantime, to 16. Stuart Appleby on the tee.
Well, I think the engraver can start putting on P-E-T-E-R. Right about now. Par five come. And he certainly looks the goods.
Well, Paul Gow and Richard Green heading to 14. Brett, a quick flyover of this par five.
Yeah, last real opportunity except probably for 18 for a birdie. Yeah, if you can get it into this area down around 260, 70 metres off the tee, good opportunity to get home in two. Now, Richard Green is one under. And he has the length to get home to make eagle. And it's exactly what he needs at the moment. And it is playing down breeze at the moment. And the pin back left. You see one eagle today, 24 birdies, playing 4.61. So with the wind blowing over the player's shoulder and helping on this hole, it's definitely an easy hole, if there's such a thing as an easy hole.
Tee shot crucial.
And that one eagle that you saw come up was the other left-hander, Greg Chalmers.
Yeah.
That's in the go zone.
Enjoyed a little mini run, did Greg Chalmers there, enabled him to finish with a final round 69.
Paul Gow. In the greenside trap, a little further away from the stick than Peter Lonard was. Should get some help from the breeze, though. Very good shot.
Now Pampling.
That's okay.
Gee.
No problem.
He took the tiger line, but he went right over the top of us.
Well, I thought you might have needed a haircut there.
I nearly got one.
Paul Gow, chance here to move to two under. That would put him in outright second spot, clearing away from Appleby and Bowditch and Green.
Gee, he's missing it at the right again. That's three I can think of today that he's missed a short putt to the right.
Well, Lonard leads by three.
And when only eight players, Sandy, have broken par today, Lonard four under par for the day. Fantastic stuff.
Moment, and the Peter Thompson-designed Moona Links on Victoria's Mornington Peninsula was the host for the 2003 Open, a true Lynx course that is at the mercy of Bass Strait's perennial sea winds. But to Thompson's dismay, the savage sea gusts did not arrive. But the force instead of New South Welshman Peter Lonard did. He shot a masterful 69 on the final day to close out his closest rivals in Chris Downs and Stephen Leaney. It's interesting that 10 years earlier, ill health had forced him close to retirement, but now, at age 36, Lonard claimed his first national title. His win at Moona Links, as sweet as they come. And who knows, he may be not far away from rewriting the record books and making it number two. To our Schweppes hotshot, and you can guess which one it is, Brett.
Not hard to pick, is it, Sandy? This one right here. I think this is the championship winner. And what a beautiful shot it was. Had eyes for the hole.
Jack, it'll still be a nervous wait for him in the clubhouse, won't it? He may lead by two or three by the time he finishes round, but then he's got to wait for all these other groups to finish.
Yeah, true, Sandy, but I think he knows that the shot that he's got right here now can close the door of any possible miracles happening where he does end up in a playoff. I mean, of all our Schweppes hot shots, that was it. That, I think, has won the tournament for him.
There are eight players behind him, four groups.
Well, it's his to lose right now, really, on this par 5 18th. Watery grave, all the way short, right around the front right and up the right side of the green. This is where he's driven the ball. And really, he's in the go zone And the length that he's hit it, he's only got 4 iron home. And I know what I'd be doing. I'd be blowing it over the back of the green. And Radar, I know you're down there. I'd be blowing it over the back of the green right up against the Hill Ross sign, getting a free drop and chipping it back down. How about you?
193 he's got, Brett. It's going to be a 3 iron. I don't think there's any doubt. I don't think he'll be short unless he fats it. Mine would be back or left trap. Wouldn't be a bad play either.
Yeah, that'd be the smart play.
But he's very happy. He's joking down here with everyone. And
why wouldn't he?
He's a light-hearted bloke.
Why wouldn't he be? He's just birdied 5 of the last 7 holes.
Yeah.
I'd be happy.
Couldn't happen to a nicer bloke, to be quite honest. Smothered it left of the trap for the gallery. Now that is interesting now, guys.
It's landed on the pathway.
That has flown.
And taken a huge leap forward.
Yeah.
And as Radar said, he's now got a downhill pitch shot to play over the bunker, water on the other side.
That could be over in the Riviera on the ninth lake.
It's like a rocket launch of that path, isn't it? Okay, it's not over yet. Richard Green, second shot to the par 5, 14th.
Needs a blue flamer and he's cut it. Gone left. And that is not what he had. What you wanted to do. You had to turn that over and at worst miss it in the right-hand bunker.
Appleby, second to 16.
The last three somehow. Oh, goal.
Jeez, that was unlucky. That kicks a little bit left. It feeds down to the pin from there.
Back to Pamps on the par 5, 14th.
Time for a rock. It's now 240 metres, 3 wood, right at the flag. It needs to hit just in front of the green because it's come out hot. Wow, that looked fantastic from back here.
Can't play it any better than that.
Paul Gow short-sighted himself here in the par 3, 15th. This is one tough shot. This will take all of his experience and skill to get this even with inside 10 or 12 feet.
Number of players have battled on the back nine today. Paul Sheehan finished with a final round 77 to be 7 over. Stephen Lenier 73 to finish it, plus 2.
Look at this shot. Out of the rough, over the bunker, no green to work with. Need some chewing gum on the club face to get it to stop. And, well, I don't think that's too bad from there. Still got a chance at a 4.
I know Peter Lonard will be definitely waiting for a ruling.
I think the corner of the stand might be in his line. Let's see here. Wayne Riley, you're with the group. Can you tell us whether he's looking for a drop or whether he...
No, there'll be no drop, Jack.
What's the lie like?
The lie is as good as you'd want to expect, but it's I think he'll play it left, taking the water totally out of play, and then just go for the two putt.
Is the bunker in play, Radar?
The bunker's not in play, no. It's the water's in play behind because he's on the downslope. Obviously, it's going to come out very quick. It's a fluffy lie, and he's going to hit it straight over toward the leaderboard where he's walking right now, take the water out of play, and then go for a two putt. That's my call. Be a brave man to toss it up there and go for the flag with that aqua right behind him.
It's a great shot, isn't it? The golfer and his fans. He would have had to move 1,000 of them. But great to see the kids there enjoying the game all day. And, of course, the members.
Just look at the galleries, though.
Fantastic.
All the way back down 18. Gallery still on 17, still following the last group on 15 and 16, 14. They have been good this week, I must say. They must be very pleased here at the Australian Golf Club. They've flocked out here for the Centenary Open. and they've seen some great golf, no doubt about that. Seen some old campaigners, Jack. We've seen a few young kids shine through.
Yeah, I think the other thing that the public should recognise is that it is an Australian Open played on one of our toughest golf courses. I mean, I think we tend to get a bit flabbergasted with the scores that they shoot on the US Tour, but if you put a US Tour field down here, the scoring wouldn't be any better, let me tell you.
I'm with you.
It's just like playing a US Open or, you know, one of the majors, where every shot in the book has to be played. Just heard Peter Lonard take a deep breath.
Club face way open, Jack. Played it well. Oh, got a nasty knuckle kick, but that's as good as he could do. I mean, that is just a fantastic shot.
Well, he's still got his work cut out. He's still got to chip it. But we saw on 17 what he can do with a chip shot, haven't we?
We'll rejoin him in a moment. In the meantime, Stuart Appleby is eyeing his ball and line at 16.
This is a must make.
Yeah.
It's makeable.
This for outright second, and considering Lonard's position.
He's got it.
Yeah. Oh, yes. So Stuart Appleby.
Hang on a moment. Hang on just a moment.
This.
Better get the PTER off the Stonehaven Cup just for a second. Just for a second, Brett.
Yeah, I know. Well.
And if he makes this, this is for four as well to get to two under Richard Green. It's got to go, though. But he's still got holes to go. There's only three.
In
double, you've got Stuart Appleby, who's picked up a birdie. He's now two under, and he's got 17 and 18 to play.
First part of the equation is to get this on the short grass. Beautiful shot from Appleby. Tough shot though, pinned back left. Difficult to get at it.
The 2001 champion battling it out with the 2003 champion. What a way to finish in our Centenary Open presented by Hillross.
Here
now,
we go.
Brett.
Oof. Uphill, just outside left flip. Made one last year to win the Open at Moona Links this length. Can he do it again?
This for par.
I tell you, it's tracking.
Oh. And the margin now is just one stroke.
My goodness.
He finishes with a round of 68. Fantastic back nine.
33 with two bogeys on the back nine, including that six. Listen, I've just always been a big believer in you never give a sucker an even break in this game.
Dead right, Jack.
Richard Green. Tee shot on the par 3, 15th. Jacobs Creek hole.
Lovely product, isn't it?
Fine drop from South Australia. And of course, sponsor of the Jacobs Creek Open.
Oh, great shot. Come on. Come up on. The tee. Get up. Stop there.
Might be an opportune time, Jack, to take a Hillross flyover of this hole and just exactly see what he does off the tee.
Yeah, one of the strongest par threes, I reckon, in Sydney. And the nor'easter always into your face here, which makes it play longer than its 188 metres. Significantly, just five birdies. Averaging 3.17, that pin cut just over that little ridge there that's in our graphic. Richard Green just creeping up onto the crest of that ridge. Kurt Barnes with his putt for a birdie, so it'll be him to go first. Oh, sorry, Rod Pampling, excuse me. Both caught. Red shirts on. Of course, Kurt Barnes up ahead with Paul Gow. He's back to one over two, Kurt Barnes. We haven't seen him for a little while, but Pampling currently at even. Now, let's just surmise that he knocks this in. He gets it into the red figures. And look, that 18th hole is such a great finishing hole. Anything can happen. We've just seen Lonard take six. Pampling's length, he could make three. Crucial putt for Pampling. This is for 215. This is to get him back in the red numbers.
I think everybody in the world of golf, and especially here in Australia, was willing that one in for Pamps. Been a pretty tough weekend for the Queenslander.
Peter Lonard, a fantastic round of 68. He's now playing a waiting game, Paddy. He's got a sit and wait for Stuart Appleby and co.
Sandy, where? Yeah, I know. You're very frustrated. We're just getting our camera set up here. It's been a rush. I said you made a lot of bogeys at back nine. You said, I don't know. All I know is I made a birdies back nine. All I know is that I made bogey on the last hole.
Yeah, that's sort of the only one I can remember. But, you know, I suppose I should have chipped it down the thingo. And, you know, but, it, you know, standing over the second shot, got two under the front edge. I'm thinking, you make birdie, it's all over. So, you know, I actually wasn't thinking making bogey. And I'm going to let everyone else back in.
In that sort of situation, though, this is where your thinking in the past has been so good, hasn't it? I mean, you're normally so good in that tight position.
Well, yeah, I think I usually hit decent shots in that position. Yeah, it was a bit of a shock to hit such a bad one, you know, hit it in the wrong spot. I was thinking worst scenario in the backstand and take a drop and get it up and down. But, you know, it wasn't to be, so we'll go to the range and we'll see him on the playoff holes, I suppose.
Are you expecting a playoff? I mean, do you think Stuart can come at you in these last two?
I'm expecting a playoff. Who it is, I don't know. But that's the way you got to think, I think, once you're finished.
Oh, yeah, I know you're a little steam. We really appreciate you talking to us. I know you want to get to the range. Best of luck.
Okay. Thanks, mate.
Thanks, Pete.
Okay.
Richard Green now. This for two. It's 15 up the slope.
Tone of voice from Peter Lonard, he is filthy.
Why wouldn't he be?
Here's a big shot right here.
Jeez, he's eyeing this.
Stop there. Spin. Oh, yes. Well, he just made one from that length.
Not without a chance. We'll see what happens when we come back after the break.
Double on 16, but I'm sure Stuart will want to see what this ball does coming towards the hole. He's on a similar kind of line, and what a three that was of Appleby's. James Niddy's and Adam Crawford, the only two players to birdie 16 all day.
Four over for the day is Camilla Villegas.
Got it going a bit left, Brett. I thought Peter Lonard's chip moved from right to left. Well, I've got to think this putt, if it does anything at the hole, it's going to go left.
Yeah, I think it's probably about a ball, maybe a little bit more outside right edge, Jack.
Well, this is the time.
Could he steal the championship? Birdie, birdie, birdie finish. Appleby.
My goodness. There's no reason why he can't.
Absolutely. There's no law against it.
No. Following that emotional win in 2001.
And I don't think Stuart would know that Lonard has bogeyed the last.
I think you're right, Brett. I'm not sure that there's a leaderboard anywhere near there.
Big putt.
Just to share the lead.
Left.
Yep. So he's got the par five last to try and pick up a shot.
Birdie to tie.
And force the playoff. We weren't going anywhere, Jack, anyway.
I'd like to see that.
Richard Green on the tee at 16.
Yeah, every time that left shoulder gets high, he seems to lose it to the left.
I think Bob Estes would be pretty pleased with his week, Jack. He shot a 73 today and finished two over for the championship.
Great to see him here. Paul Gout, 16. Look at this shot. Touch of a surge in that. Brilliant shot. He likes it. Cheeky little thumbs up.
Now, let's just clarify the situation here, Jack. Peter Lonard gone to hit balls. Not happy, Jan. After a frustrating finish, Stuart Appleby has one to play. It's a par five. He has an excellent chance of a birdie. Stephen Bowditch is in the clubhouse. He can do nothing more. Richard Green is still there. And Alistair Presnell, one of the success stories of this week, is also back in the clubhouse. So if there is to be a playoff, you would suggest that Stuart Appleby is going to be the man to try and chase down Peter Lonard.
Yeah, well, there was nothing happening for him, was there? He was out in 37, two over par, dropped a stroke at the 10th, and then he's birdied 12, 14 and 16. So three good birdies there after dropping a stroke at 10.
A couple of other names there in those top half, top dozen. Martin Doyle has had a good week, but here's Appleby.
Shot.
Must on the fairway. Absolute must.
Yeah, and a terrific ball follow there. And it's just trickled into the semi, but a good spot to come in from, and it's out of the bunker. If you put it in the bunker, you can't go at the green anyway. So he's in the go zone.
And here is Peter Lonard. Fully expecting a playoff. Staying warm and as loose as possible.
That's the location of Stuart Appleby's ball. He's got 187 with water all the way up there, and he's got to get a four. And Wayne Riley's down there on the fairway. Wayne, what's the lie like? Perhaps he's too close to talk. So
we take 16 metres, Jack, off 187. He's got 170 metres to carry the pond at the front of the green.
That's a bit of a smelly lie, sitting down in the grass, so it's not difficult to hit this fat.
It's an iffy lie, Jack. Yeah, as you said, he's got 187. I'm surprised he's having a crack at this. I mean, honestly. It's one of those, if she jumps, he'll be fine. And it has. Heading towards the left trap. Airmailed it. That's in good shape right there. That's a hell of a shot.
And with the short game that that man has, you really expect him to get that up and down from there.
Well, it wasn't a lie, Brett. He could cut it, was it? It was always either going to come out hot, like Radar said, or he was going to fat it.
Yeah.
Quick chip, right, though, down that slope.
Back to him in a moment. In the meantime, Richard Green, third shot to 16.
Rigor mortis has set in. No. We apologise for that.
Right, problem. We'll let you know what transpired with Richard.
So we go to Villegas. He's shot here into the par 5, 18th.
Much better lie, too. You can see he's on the very short cut. Appleby in the just light semi. See the flags down there on top of the Hillross stand, line from the right.
This is a name you'll see in years to come in the world of golf, this young Colombian, just 22 years of age, good player.
Tugged it left. Tugged it.
He's a hard taskmaster, that's all I'll say.
He's tugged it, 9 metres left?
Bat for an eagle.
Well, that sounded really fat.
It did, didn't it?
Left. Sounded terrible.
Now, a resident of Gainesville in Florida, had a marvellous record in his home country. Stuart Appleby knows this walk only too well. Possibly not a lot of times in this situation where he's got a chance to force a playoff with Peter Lonard. And in this, the biggest event on our golfing calendar, the Hillross Australian Open, and to win it in its centenary year, you're rewriting the history books. And I'm sure, Stuart, as he walks down here, he knows how he's finished this hole. Look, each day, birdie, birdie, birdie. He's only got to do it again, Jack.
Yeah, but can he do it when it counts most?
That's the big question. I'm sure he's thinking of that as they both get a fine ovation coming down the 72nd hole. He acknowledges the galleries. Very, very popular player. So tragically lost his wife, Renee, in a shocking accident. Has fought his way back, has started a new life and a new career. He won the Open in 2001. He's now has a new partner and wife, and they're expecting their first child. And life is good at the moment for Stuart Appleby.
Yeah, Ashley, his new wife, wonderful girl. What a year he's had, though. It's just been up, you know, win, a second, a third, five top tens, 14 top 25s, and just a smidge under $3 million US dollars.
It'll make the bank manager happy, Brett.
Mm. I just want to say that, you know, Alistair Presnell, what a great finish for him, too. He's going to earn something around the vicinity of $50,000 to $55,000 for this championship, depending on what Paul Gow at level par and Rob Pampley finish.
Help him on his way, what, to the Asian Tour again?
Yes, next week. He's pulled out of the Australian PGA to go and play in the co-sanctioned Hong Kong Open, which is co-sanctioned with the European Tour. He's currently 55th on the order of merit in Asia, just 14 starts.
And it gives him cash, Brett, doesn't it?
It's great. It's really
That's
good.
A big problem for a lot of our young players. I've said that early in the week. I think there should be some way we can get a pool of money or something that allows some of these young fellas who've got no money to at least embark on their careers. And I think it helps make the right decisions about your future.
And just where you saw Stuart stop, have a little practice, is exactly where he wants to land the ball. He wants to pop it up, land it where he was standing, then it'll run down a tier. Really, it's not that difficult to chip. It's all downhill, as Jack Newton said just a while ago. All you have to do is pop it about a meter on the green and the ball will do the rest for him.
It's a little harder when it's on the 18th and you're trying to force a playoff.
72nd.
Correct.
Hole.
And if it goes in.
Well, this guy showed nerves of steel at the Grand when he won. Absolute nerves of steel down the stretch. And this year at the Mercedes, he held off Vijay Singh.
Which,
we all know what Vijay Singh
is. Now is no mean feat.
I know.
So here we go. The third shot for Stuart Appleby at the 72nd hole of the Hillross Australian Open.
If I wanted a guy in Australian golf to chip this ball for me, I would put the club in this guy's hands.
Settle. It's a fair bit quicker down there than what almost everyone's anticipated.
Testing, to say the least, as he walks down with longtime caddy Joe. Anything but a gimme, Jack.
It's certainly not a gimme.
Gee.
Big putt to have to make to get yourself in a playoff.
It's pretty much a dead straight, 8 footer straight up the hill.
You can almost feel a tension around this green.
Well, I've got sweaty palms. Jack Regan and Hillross done a marvellous job. Major sponsors this year. The man from Burrawa. He's sitting back. They're staring this putt. They have the line right behind Stuart Appleby's Well, right in front of Stuart Apple's line of putt here. They'll get a good view of this one.
Villegas to go first putt. This for three. And big putt for him. If he can knock this in and get it, this for an eagle, get back to one over.
Yeah, there's a bit of a log jam on one over, isn't there, Jack? There's only one guy on plus two, and that's Stephen Leaning at the moment. That's where Villegas will finish.
Now there's two.
Yep. A round of 74 today. And nice to welcome him to his first Australian Open. He's going to stay out here for the Masters to gain further experience. So that's good news for him. But, well, it's come down to this putt as far as Stuart Appleby is concerned. If he makes this putt, he forces a playoff. If he misses, Peter Lonard is the Hillross Australian Open champion.
I read this one pretty straight. If it moves, it will try to move just a little bit to the water, but really, if he gives away the hole, it won't go in.
Well, I'm not sure. I think he'll make it. Come on, well, I'd like to see that playoff.
You can hear a pin drop.
People all around the hill, people in the sponsors' marquees, all around to the right, behind the green. This for tie.
Hold it. It's over. Peter Lonard can stop practicing. Peter Lonard is the centenary Hillross Australian Open champion. A round of 71 for Stuart Appleby. He finishes at two under par. Peter Lonard, can someone tell you the news?
Put the driver away.
It's over. It is over.
Hey?
Tell him. Someone tell him.
Falling over the line.
Falling anyway. Fallen over the line. Well done, Plod.
Did you sign it up here? Being the winner.
Well, I don't know that he fell over the line. He had a fantastic back nine. And he is, for the second time, Australian Open champion.
Rob Hampling way left in the trees there. 211 metres to go. Oh, that's a terrific shot. Keep on coming.
Gee.
How good a shot was that?
That was a get-out-of-jail job.
It was memories of me in 1990 there with all those pine trees on the 71st hole.
Richard Green now, his second to 17. Also at even par.
Needs to finish birdie eagles, Sandy. He's pushed it, or pulled it, being a left-hander out to the right. Similar position that Lonard was in.
Speaking of Peter Lonard, radar, he's with Pat Welsh at the moment. Pat?
Sandy, he can remember what he did the back nine now. You were a little steamed a minute ago. Your mood has improved dramatically.
Yes, it's amazing what, you know, 20 minutes does for you, isn't it? But, the, you know, I thought they were going to lead me away to the Hall of Shame, and, you know, we managed to hang on, so it was all right.
That 18th, I mean, we all say it's obviously a great chance of birdie, but it's not an easy birdie hole.
Well, not when you hit it 50 yards up the hill. Kill 20 people, but... yeah, you know, I'm not sure whether I'd do this, make the same decision again further down the track, but, you know, you've got to live with what you've done. You know, we got away with it.
We spoke day one, and I said defending champion, coming off a win last week, doesn't get much better, does it?
Well, it does.
Now it does.
Now it does, yeah. You know, I thought I was, well, all week I thought I hit it pretty good and didn't hold any putts, and today I hit it all over the joint and hold some putts, so... I think maybe putting's got something to do with winning, maybe.
I mean, there's still likelihood that there's miracles can happen out there, but I mean, the second time around, you join an elite group. I think the likes of Nicholas, Player, Norman, and Badley are the only four that have gone back to back.
Well, that's a nice team to be a part of, I suppose.
Well done. We're not handing over the Stonehaven Cup yet, but I fear it's not all that far away, and I'd just like to say congratulations. Another a fantastic 4 days of golf.
Thanks, man.
Thanks, Pete.
Yes, that's the four players that have gone back-to-back in the last 50 years. We should clarify that. Player Nicholas, player twice, Nicholas Norman and Badley, and now Peter Lonard.
71, 71, 68. That's damn good golf around here.
Well, what a shot this is. Paul Gow having a... having a dig at the 18th.
Got his rescue club by the look of it.
Might need some saving, Jack. Take a good shot from here.
Hook for it.
He's got the left head tilt going, so the ball's a little right. Oh, that was it. Well, I guess at even par, you got to have a crack. He holds it and makes albatross. He ties. I know it's a million to one.
Now, Kurt Barnes, I'm sure he'd just love to finish with a birdie, get back to even par. Well, he's put it over the back, which is what I think Peter Lonard had in mind, but tugged it. Chipping back down the slope.
So we go back to 17. Pampling. I'll tell you what, both these players go, Pampling holds this and Eagle's the last.
Come on.
Look out, look out! Oh. Lonard's only three under. That was moments ago. It was just off tape. This live now. Green holds this and Eagle's the last. He's three under. He's got a chance too.
Looking for miracles, I think. But here's Paul Gow, who's put his second in the lake. He's got to come back here, keep that point where across the hazard between him and the hole. And this will be his fourth shot. Just skipped up on the top tier.
Well, I don't know about you, Jack. I mean, you've been around longer than I have, but I have seen a lot of miracles happen on the last holes. Shots hold to win championships and force playoffs from miraculous positions.
Absolutely, and that's what I said when Lonard took six. He could have shut the gate entirely, but he let Stuart Appleby in with a chance, but he couldn't grab it.
Still a very good tournament for Pamps, and a good year. Green for par. So the scenario is, these two players must make an albatross. Oh, I know you look at me like that, but so long as you're still alive and you've still got your ball on the deck with a hole to play, anything is possible.
And what have they got to look forward to, Brett? The Hillross flyover for the last time.
Well, it's a wonderful finishing hole, this. It's always been a great par five. It's not a long par five by any stretch of the imagination, only 478 metres. The first key is to avoid this fairway trap. Put the ball in the fairway. Now, the players today, we just saw Kurt Barnes go in with a 5-iron, and Pampling's not quite as long as Kurt Barnes, but both these players, Green and Pampling, can get the ball out there and can go in with an iron. As we see there, no eagles and no albatrosses. 15 birdies.
I'm surprised it's actually averaging over its par of five, Brett, but just shows you what a terrific finishing hole it is. Bit of pressure, suddenly that the complexities of the hole change entirely. This for five, remember he was in the drink for the second.
Well, he's just handed another $10,000 or $12,000 to Alistair Presnell. Paul Gow. Presnell in a tie for fourth. His biggest paycheck of his career.
Just a short time as a pro. Fourth by itself is 72,000.
Well, the other good thing, Brett, is that sort of money will make him an automatic exemption on the tour for next year.
Isn't that terrific?
Which is fantastic.
74, final round for Paul Gow, one over.
270,000 to the winner. That will go to Peter Lonard. $153,000 for second place. That will go to Stuart Appleby.
I'm sure Peter wouldn't be thinking of the money so much as more the fact that he has become the 10th player in the history of the Australian Open to make it back-to-back wins.
And this is a big putt for Kurt Barnes here, talking about Alistair Presnell. Kurt Barnes currently at one over. So this would get him back to level par. So some big dollars at stake here.
Yeah, this is about a 30 grand, 25 grand putt, Jack. Go in. Got it.
Yeah, well done. What a week. And Australian golf has yet another new name to look forward to in the future. 65, 73, 72, 74 for the man from Muswellbrook, Kurt Barnes.
That's a fantastic story, both those young fellas. Sounds like the voice from Muswellbrook calling out Barnesy, Barnesy.
Pampling. Last tee. Heading left. Yeah, it'll get a lie, Pamps, no problem. Just in the semi.
It's been a tough weekend for him. 74 yesterday. And he's five over for the round today. As Richard Green hits his tee shot.
Just letting it go on the wind here, Jack. Yeah, it's going to go into the rough. No chance of reaching the green in two from there. So we take him out of the equation. Pamps is the only one that can hold it.
Good on you, Radar. You're on my side. Somebody's got an opportunity.
Well, we'll find out if they can when we return, but Peter Lonard is home. Just two players remaining out on the course. Richard Green is about to play his second to his 72nd hole.
Good safe shot he played. He couldn't do anything with it from there. He couldn't go at the green. Rod Pampling can, but...
I'd just quickly like to say, well done to Stevie Bowditch too. That putt on the last, $101,250 for the young Queenslander. Well done.
Yeah, we should have mentioned him when we're talking about Barnes and Presnell. Fantastic performance from three young fellas.
Yeah.
In the Open.
Can he hole it?
Left. So the miracles are gone. And the winner's Peter Lonard with that great back nine.
That was off tape now live with Richard Green. A little unlucky. Maybe a spin on that ball.
We haven't seen too many golf balls do that today. Early in the week, yes, but not in the last 2 days.
Just while they're walking up to their balls, we might take a quick break and come back and see them putting out. And, of course, the conclusion of the Hillross Australian Open for 2004.
Own 101, 250. Tie for third and fourth, 96,000. So it's $5,000 if he makes that putt that he'll steal out of Stephen Bowditch's pocket, you might say.
We look back over the day and there have been some wonderful highlights and the week. Jason Day has shown that he's going to be a marvellous player in the years to come. He's the leading amateur. Players that broke 70 today, Stephen Jeffress and Pierre Fulker out early. Greg Chalmers shot a 69, Alistair Presnell, a 68, Stephen Bowditch, 69, and Peter Lonard, a 68. Those are the players to break 70.
Come on, Greeny. Got it. No. A great putt. So he'll finish at level par. Round of 75 today. He tried hard, toiled. A good championship for the left-hander.
Never made a birdie, Brett, all day.
No, I said 5,000. This is a $15,000 difference.
What's the real answer?
You forgot to carry the one, did you?
No, I'm going eight.
Didn't they teach you how to subtract and...
9 and 9 are 17.
Plunkett Street.
What, in Goulburn? Not all of my friends and family, my mum, brother.
In essence, 101,000 or 72 to be split.
So $86,000 each to Stephen Bowditch and Rod Pampling.
Well played, Rod. Tough day today, 75, and he finishes at one under par.
149 at the weekend, though, not good enough.
So he makes his way to the scorer's hut and completes four maladies. We might take the opportunity of Schweppes hot shot, and there's no guessing who this will be. Peter Lonard shutting the gate on the rest of the field in the Hillross Australian Open.
Yeah, that was the shot that gave him the cushion, didn't it?
But the shot for me, I think, if I look back on this round, he had 10 straight pars, Jack, the birdie on 11, and the great iron shot in the par 3, because he backed it up on 12 and made another birdie, and from there on he never looked back, did he?
Let's check all scores, Jack, because there are some great stories that have come out of the week on that first page. Of course, Lonard, obviously, but Bowditch, as we've mentioned, Alistair Presnell and Kurt Barnes, the three young guns. And then, of course, you've got the old boys, led by Roger Davis. He's mixed it with the youngies, he's mixed it with the best, and he's still there. Martin Doyle likes playing the Australian Open. Stephen Leaney had his chances, Jack.
Yeah, he got it. He got it a couple under par on the front nine, and then let it get away from him.
Greg Chalmers, a good round today. Craig Parry, one of the few titles in this country that has eluded him.
Aaron Baddeley, slightly disappointing, I thought.
Well done,
Day. You're going to hear a lot more about this, Jason Day. He is a serious golfer.
Jeff Ogilvie would be disappointed to finish at plus eight after being in the mix. Peter Senior, good effort, and he's back to Europe again next year. Terry Price also finished at eight under. Pierre Fulker, a very good round today. He was out early, in fact, in the second group and shot 69.
Stolze, the Aprilia RSV 1000 for a hole-in-one yesterday, Sandals.
Yes, he won the ace competition.
Yeah, James Nitti's at 10 over. Slightly disappointing, although early days for him, you'll hear a lot more about him.
Nice to see John Morse making the effort to come out here in the Centenary Open. It's a pity a few more Americans didn't think like him.
Fine young man, he is.
Michael Campbell had, I'm afraid, a forgettable Australian Open, especially today.
Finished 6-4-10.
National title. Fitting, really, when you consider his form last week in New South Wales, Jack. Perhaps the pundits should have looked at him a little more closely.
Yeah, look, you can never discount Peter Lonard on a tough golf course like the Australian Golf Club. Indifferent year in America through injuries and all sorts of problems, but even that win last week, although it was not a massive tournament prize money wise, it would have boosted his confidence. And coming in here, well, for me it just seemed like it took him 65 holes to hole a putt.
And then, that was the amazing thing. Yeah. And then suddenly, click, yeah. We've seen one Peter Lonard for 65 holes,
yeah.
Into the next one.
Yeah,
the
look,
winner.
He of course, 71, 71, 71 to start with, and then not much doing on the front nine today, and then Brett was right, I thought. His putt that he holed at 11 for a 2 set him alight, and then, of course, that chip in at 17, I thought, was just fantastic.
Jack, would he draw on last year's victory, do you think, during that final round today?
Oh, I'm sure he would have. He's been there before. He plays in the toughest school in the world in America. And so I think from Peter Lonard's point of view, it was a day in the end where experience told out in the end.
Well, let's have a look at some of the highlights now of our champion in the last of our Dodo updates. It is an update that belongs to Peter Lonard, and it starts with his second shot to the first.
Beautiful shot right at the opening hole, but the slope just dragging it away from the cup. And then proceeded to leave the putt about 2.5 metres short.
From there we move to the 11th, and this is just about when things start to move for Peter Lonard.
Well, he probably would have seen a leaderboard as he turned Sandy after 9 holes. And you just can't hit a better shot than that. Where that pin is cut today was very close to that trap. And of course he made it.
This was a monster, wasn't it, at 12? And this really was the turning point. This is when the Peter Lon we know from Moona Lynx came to the fore here at the Australian. Yeah, and he looked in control, didn't he? He looked calm, and he just looked as though, yes, this is mine.
This was a huge putt here at 15, a hole that not many people get birdies at. And just a wonderfully controlled little chip from off the green.
He knew then.
At the 71st hole, that's some shot to make when everything's happening.
And here it is, his walk up the 72nd hole.
I was a little surprised, I must say, with both his chip and Stuart Appleby's chip at the last hole. Very quick down there, and both of them miscalculated how quick it was down that slope.
Well, then he had the waiting game, and he was a little frustrated when he walked off 18. He was more than frustrated. He was not happy.
Well, as I said, you never give a sucker an even break, because when you do in this game, someone will produce something that, proves to bring you undone. And I think Peter Lonard thought when he took 6 that he'd actually thrown away a chance to wrap up the championship.
Well, he has wrapped it up. It's time for the presentation. Here's Pat Welsh.
Sandy, thank you. Yes, an afternoon of drama that will be long remembered from here at the Australian Golf Club. And I have the president of the AGU here, Peter Spence. Peter, a fitting finale to the Centenary Open.
Absolutely, Pat. We're absolutely delighted with the way it went today and for the whole week, as a matter of fact. And we couldn't be happier with Hill Ross, with the Australian Golf Club. A great finish. What more could you want?
The golf course, I must say, was presented in magnificent order.
Absolutely stunning. I don't think I've seen a better prepared course.
You have the most important piece of silverware in Australian golf.
I do indeed, Pat, the Stonehaven Cup, and it's my great pleasure to give it to Peter Lonard for a second time. Congratulations, Peter. Well
Thanks
done.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Pete, we've spoken. We know about the desperate start to the year with the broken rib 8 weeks out, and all of a sudden it was a win last week. Things started to turn around.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a long year, so the last 2 weeks is start of next year, I suppose, really. It's been a grind, and last week got a little bit of form, and this week we finished off, particularly on the back nine anyway.
I think I asked the same question last year. What does it mean to a young Australian golfer to win their National Open?
Well, it's everything. I think, when you're a young fella and you're on the practice putting green, you're doing all your hours getting ready to be a golf pro, you're always holding that putt to win the Australian Open, aren't you? So, I thought I'd missed one to lose it this week, but I got away with it, so it's just a wonderful feeling.
It's not just this time-honoured trophy. There are more spoils, and I think you know Jack Regan, the managing director of our great sponsors, Hill Ross. He has a sizeable cheque in every sense of the word to hand over.
Thanks, Peter. My pleasure to hand over to you a cheque for $270,000 on behalf of Hill Ross. Well done.
Fantastic. Thanks, Jack.
And Jack, just quickly, we spoke earlier in the day out on the course. Again, a fitting finale. It was just high drama, high sporting drama.
It was. The cream rises to the top, Pat. Two of Australia's finest golfers in Peter Lonard and Stuart Appleby there at the end. And Hardy's congratulations to Peter. I think there's only ever going to be one centenary champion for the Australian Open, and it's hard to think of anybody more deserving than Peter Lonard. My heartiest congratulations, Peter. It's a fabulous performance. Well done.
That's right. This is about to sink in. There will be no other centenary champion. You are him.
Yes, at least someone will remember me, I suppose. Fantastic. You know, just to defend the title is great, but the fact that it's a centenary event, you know, it was wonderful. The whole week's been fantastic. Australian Golf Club has put in a wonderful golf course. You know, my favourite course in Australia, almost the world probably. And you know, it's just been a great week. Thanks, everyone.
All right, on behalf of Hill Ross and everyone who's worked here, there's been hundreds of volunteers involved. It's been a fantastic week and a fitting champion, Sandy. I'm certain you'll agree.
He certainly is the fitting champion. It's tough to win your national title, but it's even tougher, Jack, to win it back-to-back.
Well, it's tough to defend any title. There are round north right putt-putt's difficult enough, but to defend the Australian Open Championship is no mean feat. But I think, as Jack Regan just said then, you know, he's a class act, a really highly respected player. His peers have a great deal of respect for him, and the general public, I think, enjoy watching Peter Lonard play golf.
Well, I know two other gentlemen who've enjoyed the past 4 days very, very much, Wayne Riley and Brett Ogle. Brett?
Well, Rado, I tell you what a wonderful Centenary Open Championship we've just seen. Did the right guy win the championship?
Peter Lonard last year, this year, he's happy. I tell you what, he's a great fitting champion. I followed in the back nine and he was sensational. Held some clinching putts and just was really, really good. He was pumped. Bogey on the last, but so what? It's all done.
Well, it's been a tough 4 days, especially on the weekend, hasn't it? The greens really got firm. They really got crusty, didn't they? Just like South Dowling Street out there. The boys in the tail end of the field really found it tough, didn't they, to really hold the ball in the greens, and they really struggled, didn't they?
The back nine showed up today. Experience come to the top. I mean, Lonard was very good, and Appleby was right there with him. You know, it was fitting. I mean, Appleby and Lonard together, going head-to-head, it was great. It was strange. You know, we all didn't think Lonard probably was the man at the start of the day. We weren't really talking about him. Five or six behind, but here he is holding the big cup again.
Now, Radar, your favourite Radar moment?
Lonard's chip in at 17. I think that was sensational.
What about Stoltz's RSV 1000 Aprilia shot? That was something awesome, wasn't it, on Saturday?
Yeah, we were there, and that was a great shot. But, you know, to hold that jug for Lonard, I mean, the way he chipped in on 17 was just sensational. And the whole championship was great. The AG, you have done a great job this week. Hill Ross, everyone around. I had great fun.
I had fun. Did you have fun?
Wonderful.
We all had fun. Back to you, Sandy.
Those two really do worry me. They started the day in front of that Riviera and they're still there. Four players only in red figures, Jack, and it is our national championship. That's the way it should be. No easy test, but just a couple of young guns there to watch in the future, namely Mrs. Bowditch and Presnell, along with Kurt Barnes. We might have a look too and see what is coming up in the future, because it is a very busy time as far as golf on the Seven Network is concerned. And of course we move ahead through to the summer, and the Australian Open is one of the highlights on the tennis calendar. But from the Hyatt Regency Cool, and that's where the action comes next weekend, Saturday and Sunday. This is the Cadbury Schweppes Australian PGA Championship. An excellent field is being assembled for this PGA, headed by Greg Norman and Adam Scott. So you'll be able to see all that action for 5.5 hours on Saturday and Sunday. The MasterCard Masters is on the following week, the 9th through and 12th, for all 4 days, Thursday, Friday, Saturday and Sunday. Jack at Huntingdale, when once again
the tradition will continue.
And the Heineken Classic we've got in February after a break over Christmas, and then following that on the 19th and 20th of February, it is the Jacobs Creek Open in South Australia. So a big, big summer of golf here on Seven, but I think it's fitting that we leave you here from this fabulous course. It's been a wonderful 4 days, and fitting that the defending champion does exactly that. Peter Lonard once again is the Australian Open champion, this time for 2004.
Centenary Hill Ross Australian Open Champion.